Move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 1412 in the name of Michael Russell on implications of the EU referendum result and the UK negotiating position. I would invite all members who wish to speak in this debate to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call on Michael Russell to speak to and move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I move the motion in my name. Presiding Officer, the First Minister updated Parliament last week on the work which has taken place since the EU referendum, provided further information earlier today to the European Committee. I won't repeat the detail of her statement, but I will emphasise what she has made clear by her actions, that the Scottish Government has lost no time in engaging fully and robustly on all fronts. Getting the right deal for Scotland, the best deal for Scotland, in circumstances not of our choosing, must be the shared aim of every member in this chamber and everyone in our country. I'd like at the outset to echo her welcome for the European Committee report this week, which makes a valuable contribution to this urgent debate, and which rightly prioritises access to the single market and reassurance for EU nationals living here. Presiding Officer, Harold Wilson, a key player in the engagement of the UK with Europe, once observed that success in political office required the ability to get a good night's sleep with a key sense of history. I'm not expecting too much sleep in the coming weeks, but I do think that the history of the UK's post-war engagement with Europe is instructive. Britain stood aside when the nations of a divided and devastated continent came together and envisaged a common future in the 1950s. But when, confronted by steady British decline and the resurgent economies of Germany and France, we changed our mind in the 1960s, de Gaulle vetoed British applications to join on two occasions, concerned that the UK had what he described as a deep-seated hostility to European engagement. He was talking from experience, but he was also very prescient. For that deep-seated hostility drove, in part at least, the Leave campaign this year, and it still drives some of the hardest Brexiteers. Only in the 1970s was the third attempt to secure membership successful. Yet we are now back to where the Prime Minister at that time, Ted Heath, feared we might end up if his efforts had not been successful. For the UK has decided to deny itself and its people, in Heath's words, in the final House of Commons debate on EU membership in October 1971, the opportunities available to us on a wider and more prosperous stage. Leaving, as he feared we might, so many aspects affecting our daily lives, as he put it, to be settled outside our own influence. The question for us in this chamber today is therefore very clear. How do we stop that happening? How do we avoid the damage that will be caused by a Brexit we did not vote for, and which we do not believe will improve or assist this nation? On the 28th of June, this... Of course.
Neil Findlay.
Mr. says we didn't vote for it. We participated in that vote as members of the United Kingdom. The United Kingdom voted to leave. We were part of the United Kingdom.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm sure Mr. Findlay is delighted by the Tory cheers. That proves the point. There is a basic difference between Mr. Findlay and I on our understanding of nation and nationhood. I understand that the people of Scotland are sovereign. They have the right to be sovereign. They should be heard. On the 28th of June, this Parliament entrusted the Scottish Government with a mandate which gave practical effect to the democratic will of the people of Scotland. We were asked to explore all options which, of course, must include independence, to protect our relationship with the EU, our place in the single market, and the benefits that flow from that. Since that debate, the Scottish Government has sought clarity from the Prime Minister and her new Secretary for exiting the EU on how they will engage with the Scottish Government, and I'll come back to that later. But firstly, I want to take the opportunity to reiterate this Government's commitment to delivering on the mandate and invite this Parliament to continue to engage in all our efforts to do so. The First Minister has already got that process well underway. Her Government has reassured business, taken measures to stabilise the economy and ensure that EU nationals who have chosen to make Scotland their home continue to feel welcome. In July, the First Minister outlined 5 vital national interests which must underpin the actions of the Government as we chart a way forward. Those are the democratic interest, the economic interest, the maintenance of social protection, the principle of solidarity, and the ability to exercise influence on decision-making. As we go forward, according to the mandate set for us by the Scottish people and by this Parliament, we must continuously examine how those interests would be affected by and might be best protected within all the options that are open to us. To provide... Of course.
Mr. Mike Rumbles.
Mandate given to us by our votes here in the Scottish Parliament, the First Minister said, quote, emphatically not a vote for a second referendum for independence. That's why we supported it. It seems to have changed since that vote.
I think it's changed at all, but I would advise the member to listen to his own ex-leader, Nick Clegg, who was telling people yesterday he would have voted for independence in these circumstances. Mr. Rumbles is out of tune even with his own party. In July, as I said, the First Minister outlined five vital national interests. And as we go... I want to make some progress, thank you. As we go forward, according to the mandate set for us by the Scottish people in the Parliament, we will continuously examine how those interests will be affected by and might be best protected within the options which are open to us, all the options. To provide the best advice from a wide range of experience and expertise, the First Minister established a standing council of experts which has met twice. The new Cabinet subcommittee, which will deal with these issues, will meet for the first time next week. All Scottish ministers have been fully committed to working with stakeholders on the result of the referendum. The Deputy First Minister provided reassurance to EU students. The Minister for Further Education, Higher Education and Science is working with University of Scotland. Rosanna Cunningham has met with a wide range of environmental organisations, and they have strongly reiterated the key role of EU membership in tackling environmental challenges. On the 1st of September, I attended the first in a series of sectoral summits organised by Fergus Ewing. Agriculture, forestry and fishing are crucial areas where exiting the EU will have consequences, with, of course, some, such as the fisheries sector, showing enthusiasm for what they regard as new opportunities. All ministers are continuing their regular programme of engagement and dialogue, but with a new focus, ensuring that they understand and the Scottish Government then addresses the challenges brought by the referendum result. Today, I want to restate the First Minister's offer for me to meet with party leaders to listen to and discuss their suggestions and ideas. And in addition, this government has proactively reached out to our European partners with a range of visits and conversations led by the First Minister and by Fiona Hislop, who will mention, I'm sure, later this afternoon. Scotland's voice is being heard across the EU. We want Europe and the world to know that Scotland voted wholeheartedly to remain in the EU as befits a nation that is outward-looking, open, and will remain so. Since the new Prime Minister took office, the First Minister has met with her and has spoken with David Davis. I've also, in the last 3 weeks, written to him on two occasions. Nonetheless, the message from the United Kingdom government has been confusing and largely devoid of content. Not even is there no roadmap, there doesn't even seem to be a direction. It may be that a hard Brexit, with all the damage to jobs and the economy that it would cause, is the desired destination. Indeed, just last weekend, the Foreign Secretary lent his weight to a hard-line campaign, which demands UK control of laws, borders, money and trade, as it puts it, and moreover appears to demand such control immediately. Most alarmingly of all, we have no idea, none whatsoever, whether or not the UK wishes to remain within the single market, although almost 3 months have passed since the referendum. And we do not, of course, know the full scale of the impact of that result, though the UK government's own analysis suggests Scotland's GDP could be more than £10 billion lower if we leave the EU. That's why the First Minister has talked with such passion about the single market and the importance of the four freedoms which underpin it. Freedom of movement for goods, services, capital and people are what makes the package work. The last intervention, I think, please.
Adam Tomkins.
I'm grateful to the Minister for giving way. The First Minister in her statement last week talked about membership of the single market, and the Minister, I think, is alluding to that in his remarks this afternoon. Will the Minister agree with me that there's no such thing as membership of the single market? The question is, how much access to or participation in the single market do we now consider to be in the national interest?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it has been commonly described as membership because it requires active participation to secure the four freedoms. There is a difference between that and the image of a single market as a sort of shop at which you knock at the door. And if you allow me to develop the point, I shall make it. The freedom of movement, as I said, for goods, services, capital and people are what makes the package work. They create the fair competition, which is a whole raison d'etre of the single market. Without them all, there is no such thing. It's about a level playing field. And that, of course, extends to the social protections we value so highly. For equity for Scotland's workers, as well as for prosperity for Scotland's people, we mustn't be dragged by the hardline Brexiteers out of that single market. And this is a case we must make loudly and clearly. And in doing so, we will find many across these islands who believe the same and who can join us in the fight. I'm therefore today in the motion before us inviting this Parliament to add its voice to the millions who recognise that the best way to protect Scotland's and the UK's interests is to be a member, a participant in the single market. Our approach to these negotiations has to be detailed and comprehensive, but it's also got to be rooted in our values and our principles. It has to be based on a vision of who we are as a nation and how we see ourselves going forward as part of the world around us. For example, our core values of equality and inclusiveness mean that when we talk about economic growth, what we value is inclusive growth. Growth that's in keeping with our social and environmental, as well as our economic needs, and that benefits the whole country, from Lerwick to Lyng. Our desire for participation is not only rooted in democracy, but also in recognition of the progress that the European Union has made in protecting and promoting human rights. Our belief in equity will drive our demand for continued social protection. Our care for our heritage and our country will ensure that environmental issues are at the heart of our negotiating stance. It is time that that negotiating process got underway in order we can start to bring forward those views. Presiding Officer, we took Theresa May at her word when she said, as she did to Andrew Marr 2 weeks ago, that the Scottish Government will be fully engaged and fully involved in the discussions. We are prepared to accept at face value her commitment that she won't be triggering Article 50 until she thinks that we have a UK approach and objectives for negotiations. It's unfortunate I can't today report in detail on the processes and structures which are to be put in place to deliver the UK approach. I understand the challenges there are in obtaining agreement to that across all administrations. I'm sympathetic to the practical nature of those problems. However, in the intervening period, this Parliament would not expect me to be idle. To that end, I've sought a bilateral meeting with David Davis, and as the First Minister announced earlier, I'll meet him tomorrow in London. I'm not known as a taciturn politician. This Parliament is founded on the principle of transparency and expects openness. And of course, there will be a place for discretion and appropriate times for reporting to this chamber. But there also has to be a place for open discussion. Democracy and devolution demand it. And that's a key point. I was pleased to see it raised in evidence to the House of Lords EU Select Committee last week. When the nations of these islands do start to talk about the future, we will stress, as no doubt others will, the absolute necessity of respecting the devolved settlement and the areas of devolved responsibility, and of respecting and living up to the modern idea of an open, accessible, distributed democracy, which the devolved parliaments of these islands embody. Presiding Officer, we said we stand ready to listen and to speak. To listen to the communities, interest groups, and citizens of the country and understand their many concerns. To listen not just to those who voted to remain, but also to those who voted to leave, and to address their hopes and fears as well. And as we do so, we'll build our negotiating stance informed by those conversations so it's focused firmly and relentlessly on how we get the very best deal for Scotland, as well as help to get the best deal for the UK. We'll work together across this Parliament, across the country, and across these islands to achieve it. My job is and will be a collaborative one, tasked with coordination and communication. I'll work across government and, of course, with this Parliament. I'm pleased this is only the first of the parliamentary debates on these issues we're having today. And the committees of the Parliament will be active too, and if I can be assistance to them, I will be. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, let me finish where I began. Scotland's engagement with Europe didn't begin in 1973 with UK accession, nor with the post-war growing together of former adversaries. Scotland's history is intertwined with the countries of the wider continent. Our goods were sold there, our soldiers fought there, our students attended European universities. They brought things back to goods, learning, and ideas. In this very city, Sir Robert Sibbald, the first professor of physic at Edinburgh in 1685, returned from studying at Leiden and went on to create one of my favourite places, our famous botanical gardens, based on Dutch models for medicinal gardens. We are and always have been an outward-looking people, keen to adapt to new ideas and tackle difficult problems. European engagement made us, at least in part, what we are. So who we become going forward from here will be dependent on continuing in that same way. I look forward to working with everyone who shares that view and who wants to ensure that whatever the current problem, Scotland, as a European nation, continues to flourish.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Just before I call Jackson Carlow to speak and move Amendment 141.2, can I ask members who are hoping to speak in the open debate to press the request to speak buttons now? They haven't all done it. Mr. Carlow, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I speak in support of the amendment in my name, which I formally move. On June the 23rd, the United Kingdom voted to leave the European Union. After a heated political summer, if not a weather-warm summer, we move from heady excitement, immediate political confusion, wishful hot speculation and partisan fancy to the more mundane but extended period of pragmatic preparation within and between governments ahead of the moving of Article 50 and the negotiations which will determine the future shape of the United Kingdom's relationship with the EU certainly, but the wider world just as importantly. Last week we heard from the First Minister, just as the Europe and External Relations Committee did at lunchtime today, and I made clear last week my dismay at the statement to Parliament made by the First Minister, which I noted, if designed to enhance Scotland's influence in the development of the UK negotiating position, was in its tone and content entirely self-defeating. This is not a Scottish government of diplomats, and it is certainly, on the evidence of last week, not led by one. However, I took far greater encouragement from published and more nuanced remarks from Mr. Russell at the weekend. Indeed, I was almost moved to flatter them on Twitter before my better judgment took hold. So let me welcome Mr. Russell to the front bench in his new role. This government may lack diplomats, but it has in Mr. Russell one capable of diplomacy, and that above all else is the skill which can secure advantage for Scotland at Westminster as the devolved administrations seek to ensure that Scottish, Welsh and Northern Irish interests are secured. Before returning to this, I do want to address the recent sub-political context, the suggestion that the Conservative Party are the Brexit Party. The referendum on June the 23rd took place following a legislative process at Westminster. In the crucial vote at second reading, 320 Conservatives voted for the referendum with none against. 206 Labour MPs voted for the referendum with none against. 7 Liberals voted for the referendum with none against. The only Green MP voted for the referendum and not against. And yes, it's true, in the deepest of ironies, 53 SNP MPs voted against and not for a referendum. The party which favours endless Scottish referenda until it gets the result it wants voted to deny the UK a vote on Europe. The point, though, is clear. This was a referendum supported by all but one of the political parties represented in this parliament and by an overwhelming mandate at Westminster. Indeed, all the political leaders in this parliament actively fought to remain, even though 38%, over 1 million Scots, chose to leave. Indeed, as I've observed before, although this is a proportionally elected parliament, we did not in our vote here represent the Scottish electorate. Some 49 MSPs and not a bare dozen, half dozen, would have had to voted to leave had we done so. And Mr. Russell makes reference to the former Prime Minister Ted Heath in 1975. And I've looked to see what SNP leaders were saying in 1975 too. The leader of the SNP parliamentary group at Westminster in 1975 said, "The European community," Donald Stewart this is, "represents everything our party has fought against. Centralisation, undemocratic procedures, power politics and a fetish for abolishing cultural differences." And the doyen of the SNP, their subsequent president, Winnie Ewing, said that a vote to stay in the European Union would be tantamount to a death warrant, destroying Scotland's hopes of long-term economic prosperity. So the rest of the country may have listened to Mr. Heath in 1975, but the SNP did not.
Cabinet Secretary.
Fondness for praising me might move a step further by perhaps saying that we turned out to be prescient. And the Tories did not.
Mr. Carlow.
Dream on. I voted to remain. But you know, I've never assumed that I understand what finally motivated Scots individually to cast their votes either way. And I'm perplexed at the early and repeated assertion by the First Minister that she does. As one of those who voted to remain, I certainly did not do so to revive and escalate a failed campaign to withdraw Scotland from a market four times as important to us as the European Union. But in that way that she does, the First Minister asserts that she knows my mind and all others better than I do myself, or they do themselves, like my mother. She at least has the virtue of being 85. My Eastwood constituency had one of the 10 most decisive votes to remain of any authority across the UK. Yet the mood is one of acceptance of a UK referendum result, a wish for clarity and a desire for politicians to get on with it. I mean, standing in the Newlands Bakery, a successful local chain of bakers in my Eastwood constituency, more often than not one with enthusiastic queues full of anticipation, people have regularly engaged over the summer. And the highlight for me was a contribution met with a chorus of shopper unanimity when one shop assistant joined in and made her view clear. "I've had enough of this consultation. I elect you and pay you good money to represent me, and if I don't like what you do, I can get rid of you. I don't want the responsibility of having to make permanent decisions about the country's future. I actually worried and had sleepless nights, feeling the weight of that responsibility while also being underinformed to make it. Enough, get on with the job and leave me alone. As politicians, we should understand just how weary the public are. Not the evangelists and party activists, but the general public. 2 years, two general elections, and two referendums. And what is the point of breaking the tradition of our representative democracy to conduct referenda if we then choose to ignore the result? The SNP has been on the losing side of all three referenda in the last 5 years, has denounced the result of each, and would happily seek to set each aside. Presiding officer, I believe the responsibility of politicians is clear. Whatever the variable results across the UK, the result was to leave. That is what politicians are charged with delivering, what Europe and our allies, however regrettably, now expect and accept will happen. Presiding officer, I wish you to make specific reference to our amendment and the interim report of the WERC, in which it is noted that as a consequence of the committee visit to Brussels in July, when we met various EU member states and other ambassadors, that our, quote, European partners would be open to a distinctive Scottish approach to maintaining our relationship in Europe, as long as that approach had been agreed with the UK government first. These Brussels meetings were held on an unattributable basis, but one senior ambassador spoke plainly. The Scottish government must take on fully the opportunity offered by Theresa May, play a wholehearted and sincere and constructive part. If they do so, then those discussions with EU member states would proceed with the UK member state agreement and could bear fruit. However, if the atmosphere is soured and confrontational, and I use his words, then the shutters will come down all over Europe to any separate discussions with Scotland. In other words, the Scottish government can both make or break our influence and an opportunity in the exit negotiating strategy and discussions. If the siren tone of last week's First Minister is the ongoing model, then the best outcome for Scotland in the discussions will be doomed. Now, we look to Mr. Russell to prevail and to keep the First Minister working in her day job here in Scotland, one which frankly needs and deserves every moment of her attention. Presiding officer, the First Minister's tone has not been encouraging. Her obsession with independence reluctantly persuades us, notwithstanding her protestations, that her view of Scotland's interests can only be viewed through that prism. It is why Ruth Davidson has set up a group of advisers to report to me and her, and through us to the UK government, and I would encourage other parties to consider how best they respond to the conflict of loyalties with which Nicola Sturgeon has clearly wrestled for so long. We fully support the work of the European External Relations Committee in its consideration of evidence and hope this will help to substantially inform both Parliament and the Scottish Government. As Ruth Davidson said on Monday in London, just like devolution, Brexit is not a process, is a process, not an event. There are responsibilities beyond just the negotiations with our European partners. We expect the UK Chancellor to acknowledge the economic challenges arising and to address these substantially in his November autumn statement. We recognise the voices of Scottish fishermen and others who see opportunities for Scotland and their particular sectors in our shaping future policy, currently the preserve of the EU to meet our own needs. Indeed, it was Nicola Sturgeon who remarked in the early years of this Parliament, and I quote, "Centralised EU management of fishing over the last 20 years has been disastrous. It is time to return control more closely to fishing communities." Well, now we can make good on that sentiment. Beyond fishing, we have the chance to think afresh about other industries and how they are integrated with the UK. Scottish Conservatives urge the Scottish Government to work closely and with all sincerity to achieve the best possible outcome from negotiations which will see Scotland and the UK leave the EU. That best outcome extends beyond trade. Can that best be achieved with restrictive red lines? I doubt it. The EU itself is not fixed in stone. Significant national elections take place in its larger member states next year alone. Pressures for change are evident across the UK. Our negotiation is not with a fixed edifice, but with an evolving union, and the shape and terms of the best outcome for Scotland and the UK will evolve too. We will encourage, contribute to, and support the Scottish Government and Mr. Russell when that too is their priority. We expect to hear from him regularly and wish him well in the discussions which must inevitably commence in detail, indeed tomorrow, with the Secretary of State, David Davis.
Thank you. Can I ask members and openers try to keep to your time? It's very tight. I call Lewis MacDonald to speak to and move Amendment 1412.3, 7 minutes, Mr. MacDonald.
Thank you very much. Michael Russell's opening speech was well trailed, both in the press on Sunday and by what the First Minister had to say at the European and External Relations Committee earlier today. He also added a historical perspective, which is welcome, although, of course, there was nothing inevitable about the sudden and complete reversal of 60 years of UK policy on Europe, which happened only a few weeks ago. The government's plans for a series of debates on British exit from the European Union are welcome. There will be many consequences of Brexit, and there will be many questions that ministers will have to answer about their approach to this process in the months ahead. I hope we will hear more of the detail in coming weeks, but I want to focus today on the big picture of overall objectives. It is, of course, not just Scottish ministers who have questions to answer. Theresa May has so far failed to answer the most important question, which is what outcome her government is seeking on behalf of the whole of the United Kingdom. To be or not to be in the single market is not a matter of tactics or of horse trading to be kept under wraps until Tory ministers have seen what is on offer across the negotiating table. It is a matter of the utmost strategic significance. Mrs. May has disowned the assertion by David Davis that membership of the single market is very improbable, but she refuses to say whether she regards it as desirable. Mm-hmm. We are left to speculate on what not being very improbable actually means. The Conservative amendment today rightly highlights, as we have heard, the need for the United Kingdom as the member state to endorse any proposals the Scottish Government wants to discuss with other European governments or institutions. Mr. Carlow drew the conclusion that Scottish ministers therefore need to work in good faith with their UK counterparts in negotiations with Europe. Absolutely. But he fails, though, to acknowledge the equally obvious point that ministers in the UK will have to tell Scottish ministers and everybody else what their objectives in these negotiations actually are. If they choose not to reveal their strategic objectives, the suspicion will grow that what the Tories really want is to have all the benefits of membership of the single market with none of the obligations. A Europe of free trade and high profits with fewer rights for working people, fewer protections for consumers and lower environmental standards. I doubt if many Leave voters in Scotland's inner cities or the fishing ports of Moray or Buchan thought that that is what they were voting for. So before the Conservative Party calls for the devolved administrations to work in good faith with Mrs. May's ministers, they need to show their good faith by telling us what kind of British exit from the European Union they are actually trying to achieve. Transparency is not just for Tories, of course. Scottish ministers also need to set out their stall as they engage with the UK government and tell us how they will seek to balance the many different interests represented in this Parliament and across Scotland as a whole. I accept that a start has been made on that today. The motion before us reiterates the importance of membership of the European Union, as the First Minister did earlier, and affirms that a key objective for the Scottish Government is for Scotland and the UK to remain inside the EU single market.
Mike Russell, Right Rumble.
According to the motion, the Scottish Government want to participate fully in all negotiations between the UK
just
government...
Just a minute, Mr. Rumbles, your microphone wasn't on. Do you want to repeat it, please?
Yep, thank you. According to the motion, the Scottish Government wants to participate fully in all negotiations between the UK Government and the EU. In other words, it seems to me that they're wanting a veto here, and surely that is not the purpose of this amendment, and I'd be astonished if Labour are supporting this.
Mr. McDonald.
Well, I think the position that we all agreed as a Parliament was that the Scottish Government should negotiate and explore options, and that remains the position that we support. But as the statement in the motion of seeking to remain within the single market, this is the first strategic objective publicly endorsed by either Scottish or UK ministers, and therefore it's worth being absolutely clear about precisely what that means. Because there is indeed a single market, which includes the United Kingdom, and remaining inside that market is a clear objective. It is not, however, a European Union market. It is the single market of the European Economic Area, which we are also inside by virtue of Britain's membership of the EU, but which is not confined to European Union member states. And Nicola Sturgeon confirmed earlier today her objective that Scotland and the UK should remain inside the European Economic Area, even as the British government implements its commitment for Britain to cease to be a member of the European Union. And Adam Tompkins' intervention was quite wrong. It is indeed possible to be a member of the European Economic Area, even out with the European Union. And that is why the European Committee met in Brussels with the ambassadors of the two leading such countries, Norway and Iceland, which are full members of the single market in just the same way that we are. But if, of course,
Mr. Tompkins.
I will not accept that membership of the EEA was designed as a way into the European Union, not as a way out of the European Union, and that EEA members have to accept the full subjection of supranational law from the European Court of Justice, so there's no sense in which national legislation it can be returned, sovereignty can be returned to national legislation, so there's no taking back of any control with EEA membership.
Well, Mr. MacDonald.
And in fact, by the very description that was included in that intervention, Adam Tompkins has confirmed that that is indeed a membership organisation, that the single market is something you can be a member of. We have membership, and like Norway and Iceland, we should seek to maintain that membership. But there is a question, though, for the Scottish Government, and that is, if this is their key objective, and if that is secured by Britain remaining in the EEA and the single market after we have left the EU, the question then will be whether the mandate that this Parliament gave the Scottish Government of protecting the benefits to Scotland of our relationship with the EU will then have been discharged. If the UK remains in the single market, so does Scotland. So do ministers at that point conclude that their mission has been accomplished and that there would then be no further need for a distinctive Scottish approach and relationship with the European Union? Does the independence option then come off the table if the UK government successfully negotiates continuing membership of the single market? Because if so, that clearly puts the ball back firmly in the Conservative Court. Not now, not at some future point, but right here and now. Mrs. May will then have to decide what matters more, keeping ministers in her cabinet who want to leave the single market or getting an independence referendum off the table. If, on the other hand, SNP ministers would wish to press on regardless in pursuit of a separate Scottish outcome, then they need to tell us what else is a key objective for them in these negotiations, in addition to the one they have highlighted today. Is membership of the single market the red line for the Scottish Government, or is achieving that objective not enough? Scottish Labour wants to see more rights for working people and better protection for consumers, not fewer rights or less protection. We want higher environmental standards and trade and investments which create good and well-paid jobs. We see remaining in the single market as a means to achieving those ends, and we will work with other parties on that agenda. But calling for openness is more than just a slogan. It doesn't just apply to someone else. The Scottish Government is right to seek full participation in the talks that lie ahead, but they also need to be clear and open about what all of their key objectives and priorities will be. On that basis, Presiding Officer, I move the amendment in my name.
I have to warn members, we're already 5 minutes over, so this means, of course, the way we're going to have the later speakers in very short speeches. So we're going to have the next lot of speakers, please, a tight 6 minutes, and a little less if you can manage. I call Joan McAlpine, followed by Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I also join in those welcoming Mr. Russell to his new role? Almost 3 months on from the EU referendum, in which 62% of voters in Scotland voted to remain, we are no clearer as to what the UK government means by Brexit. It remains a mystery. It's now almost exactly 2 months since the Prime Minister visited Edinburgh, her first engagement since assuming office, and the visit was described by some observers at the time as the Prime Minister love-bombing EU-inclined Scots. But beneath headlines like that came very clear commitments from Mrs. May, who quite explicitly stated that Article 50 would not be triggered until a UK-wide approach was agreed. And if I can quote from the Prime Minister's comments immediately after that meeting with Nicola Sturgeon in July, the Prime Minister said, "We've discussed the upcoming EU negotiations, and I am very clear that I want the Scottish Government to be fully involved." I reminded the First Minister of that July quote during her evidence to the European Committee this morning, and she confirmed that this was also the personal assurance she had received from Mrs. May in those discussions, which were described at the time by both women as very constructive. But in the 2 months that have passed since then, we seem no nearer understanding how the Scottish Government will feed into the process of agreeing a UK-wide position ahead of Article 50. As Mr. Russell has indicated today, that's not due to any lack of effort on part of the Scottish Government. And I welcome the news that Mr. Russell will meet the UK Brexit Minister David Davis soon. We have progress, but it does seem that progress is very slow. It also seems to me that there has been a change of tone at UK level, certainly publicly. It seems to be cooling off from those warm prime ministerial words in July. For example, David Mundell, the Secretary of State for Scotland, who's supposed to speak for Scots in the UK cabinet, gave a television interview recently in which he appeared to throw in the towel and accept that we would be outside the single market. And he also suggested that only one of what he called Scotland's two governments would be involved in determining the Brexit process and the UK position. That's the government that only got 14% of votes in the Scottish general election last year, and where he's the sole Scottish MP. Perhaps David Mundell and his colleagues Liam Fox, like his colleagues Liam Fox and David Davis, was expressing a personal opinion when he said that. I hope so. But as an observer of the process, it does seem to me that the UK could be doing a bit of an evil as regards Scotland and the EU, just as it did last year in undermining the role of Scots MPs in the Westminster Parliament. So to repeat, we were promised a UK-wide approach, not an appeasement of English Brexit voters, which ignores Scotland, Northern Ireland, London and Gibraltar. And even the FM of Wales, Carwyn Jones, which, of course, that country voted to leave, Mr. Jones on the 9th of September said that Cardiff, Edinburgh and Belfast must be at the negotiating table. So today offers an opportunity for this Parliament to send a strong signal to the UK government to keep Theresa May's promise made back in Edinburgh in July. One comment that the Prime Minister has made since July, which has not been written off as personal opinion, regards Norway, which many people view as the least worst option when it comes to our future relationship with the EU. During the referendum campaign, even many Brexiteers held up Norway as a possible model for the UK outside the EU, and I won't go into all the arguments against that, but certainly its EFTA-EEA status means that it's part of the single market, albeit that it can't set the rules and must also pay for the privileges. But during the European Committee's visit to Brussels over recess, we heard of the advantages of EFTA-EEA status and how much it's valued by the participating countries, though it meant that they had to agree to free movement of people. But Mrs. May has already dismissed all existing models, suggesting that she can negotiate a bespoke deal for the UK, which curtails EU immigration while retaining the benefits of access to the single market. And she specifically seemed to rule Norway out in one of her public comments, which I think is very disappointing. Nobody who knows anything about Europe believes that you can square access to the single market with restricting free movement of people. And that was the overwhelming evidence taken by the European Committee to date. We found, and our overwhelming amount of evidence found, that continued access to the European single market was the preferred option. The single market's built on four freedoms: freedom over movement, capital, labour, goods and services. Free movement of people is not something that sits separately from the single market, or even which sits alongside it. Free movement of people is integral to the single market because it's one of those four freedoms. The evidence to the European Committee by the Fraser of Allender Institute was rather sobering, in the sense that it looked at different options for the UK and the economic impact that they would have. And certainly the hard Brexit, which has been alluded to by several UK ministers, was certainly the most damaging option in terms of the forecasts. It could result in...
Can you conclude, please?
It could result in a loss of GDP to the UK of anywhere between 3 and 8%. So I very much hope that that does not happen, and that the UK government listens to the Scottish government and other parties in this and comes up with a solution that enables us to have free access to that single market going forward. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Rachel Hamilton, followed by Stuart Stevenson. Ms. Hamilton.
One of my favourite quotes of all time is from Robert Frost, and he says, "The afternoon knows what the morning never suspected." And it is with this sentence in mind that we discuss the outcome of June the 23rd. The ballot paper asked, "Should the United Kingdom remain a member of the European Union or leave the European Union?" England and Wales voted to leave. Scotland, like Northern Ireland, voted to remain, as did other parts of the UK, such as London. In accepting the result, as Jackson Carlow's amendment to the motion recognises, we should support the views of 17.4 million voters across the United Kingdom. Of course, hindsight is a great thing, but democracy always wins the day. the most effective countries in the world are those who accept consensus. The Prime Minister is quite rightly demonstrating caution before deciding when to trigger Article 50 in a bid to thrash out the framework of the sort of departure deal that the UK can expect. As soon as Article 50 is invoked, the clock will start ticking and the UK and devolved governments will have 2 years to prepare for withdrawal from the treaty. The time frame is crucial and will allow the Scottish Government to feed policy positions into the UK policy. Theresa May said, our task is to negotiate a deal for exiting exiting the EU that is in the interests of the entire nation. It must be pointed out that European heads of state are sympathetic to Scotland's majority Remain vote. However, they are not prepared to intervene in internal UK discussions. Practical detail must be at the top of the agenda before Brexit negotiations can take place, and I look forward to the Scottish Government fully engaging and being involved in the process of negotiating our withdrawal. Teams of Brexit negotiators are being formed in the UK Government, and now that Mike Russell has been appointed Brexit Minister, he will meet David Davis tomorrow, and we look forward to hearing his progress in his recruitment plans for his team and of joint collaboration plans. European parliamentary committees have gathered evidence from industry and academics, and now it is time for us to work together in the best interests of the people of Scotland, England, Ireland and Wales. It would be a step forward to see a post-Brexit display of unity amongst the devolved and UK governments to ensure our enduring success within Europe and on the wider world stage. However, to put this conundrum in perspective, our biggest trading partner is the rest of the UK, and Scotland's trade is worth 4 times that of with the EU. Businesses are seeing potential in Brexit. It will not have escaped your attention that it's Scottish food and drink fortnight, and this sector is growing based on a strong home market and an expanding export presence. Further details on trade negotiations are vitally important to this sector. In particular, producers want the process of transferring goods and services in and out of the UK to present a smooth journey, ensuring that their sector reaches a projected turnover target of £16.5 billion by 2017. Yes.
Fine.
Thank the member for taking an intervention. She may recall that when Scotland Food and Drink gave evidence to the European Committee, they were extremely concerned about the effect of Brexit on access to labour, and they made the point that EU citizens formed a very, very important part of the labour force in their industry. How can she address their concerns if her government's determined to restrict migration and free movement of people?
Thank Ms. you. Hamilton.
I thank Joan McAlpine for that question. I think you're absolutely right, and it is an important part of the food and drink industry, in particular tourism, and the makeup amongst EU migrants is high within that industry. I think Mike Russell and his team need to address that and communicate that in collaboration with the UK government. Businesses are seeing potential in Brexit, and it will not have escaped your attention. Sorry, I've repeated myself. So further details on trade negotiations are vitally important to this sector. The Scottish National Farmers Union reminds us that primary producers are the foundation stone of food and drink industry, and their members are integral to the continued success of agricultural production and its wider partners. The Scottish farming industry are interpreting our withdrawal from the European Union as an opportunity to allow access to new markets and for future arrangements to work better for Scottish farmers and crofters. It is important that current EU funding streams that benefit agriculture are negotiated to replace the Common Agricultural Policy. And of course, we cannot stress the importance of research and innovation funding within the farming sector that generates significant economic return and food security. Indeed, the opportunities of leaving the European Union also present the Scottish fishing industry with many opportunities to reinvigorate its coastal and island communities and deliver a thriving, profitable and sustainable fishing industry. We have been concentrating mainly on discussions on trade relationships within the EU. That is because we consider countries within Europe are reliant and independent on our relationship with the UK, and this presents us with a positive future. However, the world is our oyster, and this presents new prospects. We must consider the scope of negotiations, and they go far beyond the confines of the European Union. Independent or bilateral trade discussions with countries such as the US, Japan, Australia and India will bear fruit as we develop relationships, and these must be nurtured. Deputy Presiding Officer, to conclude, Our role must be to mitigate economic downturn by opening up new opportunities to Scottish industries. We need to protect what works for us and drop what doesn't work for us as we move closer to forming a new relationship with the EU and the wider world.
Thank you, Ms Hamilton, for keeping to your time despite interventions. Stuart Stevenson, to be followed by Neil Findlay. Mr Stevenson.
Presiding Officer, the common fisheries policy of the EEC and EU has hung over our fish catchers in my constituency ever since the Tory government sold out our interests when they took us in. You'll not find a single occasion when I've stated it was good for us. I agree with the Scottish Fishermen's Federation when they say in the helpfully concise briefing that we need fairer and more appropriate shares of catching opportunities for the Scottish fishing industry within our own waters. It is worth parenthetically saying the establishment of the 200-mile limit did not necessarily extinguish access for countries who fished in those waters prior to its establishment, and it's not clear whether leaving the CFP delivers all these waters to Scotland, but that's for another day. My first speech on the CFP was here in 2001, the day after I was sworn in to Parliament. I was able to say then, I'm happy to agree with Jamie McGregor, who was then a Tory MSP, who spoke yesterday of the need for more local control. We in the SNP have advocated that for many years. I go further in two respects. One of the most frustrating aspects of the common fisheries policy for our fishermen lies in our ability to suspend fishing rights in an area of our interest, but only to apply to our own boats. Other nations' boats can continue to fish in areas where our boats cannot. That is something that must end. Secondly, the right to fish is essentially provided by a grant of quota from government and at no cost to fishermen. Therefore, I suggest any value associated with quota must remain a public asset. And we must look for ways to make it an asset from which local fishing communities as a whole can benefit. Equally, we need to find a way to be fair to fishermen who've paid for quota in good faith. If we need any knowledge of Tory thinking on this subject, we need look no further than Philip Booth of the Institute of Economic Affairs. He writes on Conservative Home, "The solution is to establish property rights in sea fisheries," and goes on to suggest an international trade in these rights. This is absolutely opposed by our fishermen and runs entirely counter to broader community demands for local control. Once again, an indication that the Tories wish to sell out the interests of our fishing communities. And Tories, in doing so, are departing from their previous MSP, Jamie McGregor's position, with which I was able to agree in 2001. As the Fishermen's Federation and others acknowledge, we need a new fisheries management system. Like those in Iceland, the Faroes, Norway, our fishermen need to be inside the room while the local detail is determined. That fundamentally means that control of fisheries in our waters cannot be left to Westminster, the people who took us into the CFP, and have a track record of selling us out when negotiations on fishing take place. It must instead be controlled here in this Parliament, but with significant local decision-making by local communities embedded in the process. But it's also worth saying, of course, that fishing is simply not about catching alone. The economically larger part and larger by employment is fish processing. Its interests require the free movement of people and unfettered access to the very large market that is the EU single market. I was interested that Mr. Tompkins appeared to suggest that Brexit means leaving the EU single market. I thought the question on the ballot paper said leaving the EU. It didn't commit us to leaving the EU single market. I will.
Mr. Tompkin.
I'm grateful. My view is that Brexit requires us to ask what kind of access to the single market is now in the national interest.
The national interest is clearly expressed as access to all the rights and privileges of being able, without visas, without paperwork, without costs, to be able to continue to sell into the market and to engage people from across the European Union in our industries. In my constituency, in the fish processing industry, it's proved impossible to rely solely on local labour. Factories in my constituency now, even after local layoffs, continue to have vacancies. Secondary schools in Fraserburgh and Peterhead illustrate this point with a couple of dozen languages in each of them. Being in the single market could cut us off from all of that. Merely having access can mean that all of these barriers are likely to be created and we damage the interests of Scotland and indeed, for that matter, the wider UK. Let me just say a word or two about what the Tories appear to want today. From the government motion, they wish to delete agreed UK approach, meaning they want Westminster to decide. The delete objective, Scotland to remain inside the EU market, meaning they want to damage our exports. They delete protect social protection, meaning they want to remove safety nets for the vulnerable. Finally, I understand that many of my constituents voted to use June's vote to get out of the CFP, albeit that the Leave vote in my constituency was only 1,000 more than in East Aberdeenshire. But Scotland now has interests that are important. We should, for example, lead on fishing negotiations for the UK as a whole, not delegate decisions to Westminster, but I'm not holding my breath. Presiding officer.
Thank you. Mr. Neil Findlay, followed by Claire Hawkey. Mr. Findlay, please.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. I voted Remain in the referendum after much soul-searching, and for whatever reason it happened, the result will have a significant impact in changing our politics, our society, our economy, and our relationship with our neighbours around us at home, and our overseas neighbours. But what has concerned me before and since the referendum is the way in which the political class, particularly here in Scotland, has very narrowly and uncritically framed the narrative that has emerged. A narrative that says that on every level, Brexit is a bad thing and that we must do anything and everything to remain within the EU and the nirvana of the single market. A single market that, if you are to believe the spin, is the magic rainbow that leads us to a land of fairness, justice and plenty. A narrative that fails completely to question the economic policies that have driven austerity, caused mass youth unemployment, constrained demand across the many EU states, and crippled the Greek economy. A narrative that offers little by way of any critical analysis of the reasons why so many people, 17 million of them, including 38% of our fellow Scots, were so disenfranchised that they decided to vote Leave. 38% who appear to be getting airbrushed out of the debate, unlike the 45% on the losing side of the independence referendum. Leave voters are being portrayed as little people who made the wrong decision, and they should just leave it to the wise people of the political classes. They know better. They know how to fix it. I believe that is anti-democratic and downright dangerous. It's this Parliament's role to hold those in power to account and never, ever to accept anything without a critique. And if we fail to address these issues and have an honest debate about the future of our relationship with the EU, then we do the voters and our democracy a massive disservice. A simplistic EU good, outside the EU bad mentality will not do. So there are very difficult and serious questions that need to be asked and answered. And yes, indeed, there appears to be little plan from the UK government. However, prior to the vote, the First Minister said her government were planning for all eventualities. Well, if that's the case, why does the government not share their plans? Why have they failed to release the plans under FOI when I have asked for them? Do they indeed have a plan? Are we really saying that we must have access to an unreformed single market, which is with its much heralded four freedoms that Joan McAlpine referred to? Freedom, movement, goods, people, services and capital. A single market predicated on the belief that these freedoms drive prosperity. Well, have they drove prosperity? Well, not for the 50% of under-25s unemployed in Greece, or the 43% in Spain, or the 37% in Italy, nor the 12 EU states with youth unemployment above 20%. No prosperity for millions of our fellow EU citizens. Where is the debate on that? Because we should not be... Certainly.
Mr. Greer.
Does Neil Findlay agree with our comrades in Greece who called for a Remain vote here that the only way to reform the single market is by staying in and fighting for that reform? And it's for those reasons that many of us in this Parliament call for continued membership of the single market.
Exactly,
Neil Findlay.
Exactly where I'm coming from, that we have to make that argument. I don't hear it. I don't hear that being said so far, because we're kidding ourselves in this debate. We seem to be kidding ourselves on. According to the government, it's the rules of the single market that meant we had to tender the CalMac contract. It's the rules of the single market that says we cannot take the railways or the buses into public ownership. Procurement rules that don't allow us to end 0 hours contract or demand the living wages paid to public sector contractors or address the massive tax avoidance across the European continent. Where is the Scottish Government challenge to these failings of the so-called free and single market? And what chance do we have of addressing them through the minister, who is a free marketeer? He is long on the record. Is it likely that Mr. Russell will grasp the thistle and hold out for these changes? Fat chance, I would suggest. I want us to argue for access for our goods and services, but also for change that allows us to take industries into public ownership, if we choose to do so, to collect those taxes, the taxes that rose to us, and set the living wage that we want to see set. And I want to see collective bargaining encouraged, not traded off for bailouts. And on free movement of people, some would have you believe that this policy is an egalitarian policy to allow people to visit the opera houses of Milan or to study at the Sorbonne. Well, for some, this may be true, but what it's really about is profit maximisation and a neoliberal policy driven by the desire to allow capital to locate wherever they want in order to get the cheapest supply of labour, all the time driving down wages and not enhancing workers' rights, undermining workers' rights. In the UK and Scotland, we see a steady supply of migrant labour, with workers being ripped off by gangmasters, by rogue landlords, and unscrupulous employers who exploit their plight. They need protection like any other worker. What are we demanding for them from the single market? Finally, Presiding Officer, we've had two referendums. We voted to remain part of the UK, and as a UK, we voted to leave. The government must respect both of these democratic decisions while seeking to get the best possible deal from a reformed single market.
I call Claire Hawkey to be followed by Jamie Green. Ms. Hawkey, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I first congratulate Michael Russell on his appointment as Minister for UK Negotiations and Scotland's Place in Europe. In June this year, a week before the EU referendum, while speaking on a motion welcoming the increased trade union membership in Scotland, I warned that the greatest threat to workers' rights would be a vote to leave the EU on the 23rd of June. If I was deeply concerned then about the impact of Brexit, I'm even more pessimistic now about its potential effect on ordinary workers. Some Brexiteers would have us believe that following the initial post-vote shock, things were getting back to normal, that they will get the deal they want from the EU once they've worked out what it is they actually want, and that there are few, if any, downsides. Presiding Officer, this is just a mirage. In fact, little has changed since the 23rd of June in terms of what Brexit actually means or the development of a coherent UK negotiating position. They couldn't tell us what Brexit meant then, and we're none the wiser now. What we do know is that it means different things to different people, and that's just within the Tory negotiating team. In truth, the real impact of leaving the EU has yet to be felt, and that impact, particularly if it is a hard Brexit with no access to the single market, could have serious negative consequences for almost every section of Scotland's population and economy. We send almost half of our international exports to the EU, so retaining membership of the single market matters. It's quite simply in Scotland's economic interests. For our manufacturing, engineering, for our manufacturing, engineering, food and drink and finance sectors, any loss of access to the EU market matters. The benefits cannot easily be replaced by instantaneous access to markets around the world. That access takes many years to develop. Potential trading partners such as the US, Japan and Australia have already signalled that they will not negotiate with the UK while exit negotiations are ongoing with the EU. And even then, they would prioritise deals with the larger EU trading bloc. Our universities benefit from EU funding, and many have flagged up serious concerns that uncertainty in this area will harm research projects. Ensuring access to competitive research funding and global collaborations that flow from that, and that matters. Free movement of people matters to allow EU students to continue to study here and for our students to have the opportunity to study in Europe. Many things we've taken for granted have only been possible with the help of EU funding.
I don't think members taking interventions, Mr. Johnson.
Especially in areas like my own constituency of Rutherglen, where traditional industries have declined or disappeared altogether. European regional funds have supported many projects in the area. Clyde Gateway successfully bid for EU funds for a variety of projects, including the reclamation of contaminated industrial land at Shawfield for development as a business park. Whitlaburn Community Energy Project received £2.3 million to provide tenants with low carbon heating and lower energy bills. Continued benefit from European structural and investment funding is now at risk if Scotland is pulled out of the EU against its will, as the UK government refuses to guarantee similar levels of funding will be available post-Brexit. One of the most concerning aspects of withdrawal from the benefits of EU membership for me is what we stand to lose in the area of social protection. Many of the core rights we've come to regard as normal are underpinned and guaranteed by EU legislation. The right to 20 days paid holiday, maternity protections, including paid maternity leave, time off for antenatal appointments, employment protection when pregnant, limits to working hours, health and safety protection, the right not to be discriminated against on the grounds of your age, your religion, your sexuality or your gender, the right to trade union representation, equal treatment for part-time workers and equal pay for equal work, and protection of employees' acquired rights on the transfer or sale of a business. All of these protections matter to workers. However, they will be seriously at risk if they're left to the devices of a right-wing UK Tory government. Given the unelectability of Labour at Westminster, we are potentially facing a decade or more of UK Tory governments that Scotland didn't elect, who will not think twice about eroding workers' rights to seek economic competitiveness. The UK government is all over the place when it comes to what Brexit actually means. The Chancellor wants to remain in the single market. The Brexit Minister thinks it's improbable. The Prime Minister won't say what she wants. The Foreign Minister has a record of insulting most of the foreign dignitaries he must work with, and the International Trade Minister calls UK business leaders fat and lazy. How to make friends and influence people? Just as well then that here in Scotland we have a government who are taking positive action to protect Scotland's interests. It's right that the government looks to all options to protect our place within the single market and all options to protect our workers' rights and entitlements. They are the hallmark of a fair society.
Thank you. I call Jamie Green to be followed by Mary Evans. Mr. Green, please.
Distant, centralised and monumentally complex processes which produce exactly what might be expected from such a structure, a continuous stream of largely dysfunctional rules and regulations. What's just popped into your head? You might be forgiven for thinking that we've gone back in time in this chamber, talking about the EU in its entirety. But these are not words describing the EU. These are words used by the Scottish Fishermen's Federation to describe the Common Fisheries Policy. This is a federation which is the voice of an industry which has been suffering for decades. An industry in which the workforce is now at half of the levels enjoyed in the 1970s. An industry which for years was forced to dump perfectly good fish back into the water to meet quotas. An industry which sits by and watches foreign fishermen in its waters whilst local boats are docked in our shores. An industry which described Brexit as a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, as it involves a systemic change and the restoration of our exclusive economic zone. But the fishermen of Peterhead are just a part of the song of voices in this debate. 38% of people in Scotland who voted to leave the EU on June the 23rd came from across Scotland, from Greenock to Glenrothes, from Dingwall to Dumfries. We can all agree with the First Minister that the Brexit referendum has created uncertainty in this country, and she should be no stranger to that. Every referendum with a single question invariably creates diametrically opposed views on the outcome. One side will have won, the other will have lost. As Oscar Wilde might have said to the First Minister, to have lost one referendum might be considered a misfortune. To have lost two looks like carelessness. Does she really want to try a third? The reality is that everyday life has gone on. We are obliged as Democrats to respect the outcome of our collective nations. A million Scots voted to leave the EU. And just as we respect the First Minister's desire for independence, she needs to respect the views of those Scottish people who wanted to leave the EU. The EU has struggled in its current form to survive just a few decades. The UK has survived for centuries because our bonds are deep, our interests are similar, and our lives and family trees cross the border. The First Minister said just a few hours ago that she admitted that the EU that she wants Scotland to remain part of needs reform. Mr. Juncker stood up in the European Parliament this morning and asked for even more money to fund an even bigger EU. Trouble is brewing in the EU. The First Minister said this morning, we will examine all options to protect our interests, including independence. Of course she has to say that. But we are obliged to listen to the very real concerns that caused over 1 million people in Scotland to vote leave. The members here are talking about the least worst option. Ashan, I'd like to make progress. Members here are talking about the least worst option for Scotland. What sort of defeatist language is that going into negotiation? There is an opportunity here to make our own mind up about the thousands of EU acts that we have to adhere to in the farming business. Are they all really relevant? Are they all in Scotland's interests? There is the opportunity to do deals on fishing with countries that bilaterally benefit each party. There is the opportunity to assess common agricultural policy and reinvent where it doesn't work. There is the opportunity to put some real thinking into the long-term strategy, into how we manage our land, how we grow our food, how do we export our produce. I don't need Brussels to tell me how to manage the Scottish landscape. For the first in a very long time, albeit unwillingly for some, we have been presented an opportunity to break the endless cycle where farmers' inevitable loss is broken even with a subsidy. Inevitability is not good enough. It's not just the SNP failure to pay our farmers on time, it's a failure of the entire EU system which has locked farmers into this inevitability. Brexit presents us the opportunity to create a farming, fishing or forestry industry which works for Scotland. The opportunity to do trade deals with a world who wants to trade with us. Now, people don't invest in Scotland just because it's a means to export to Spain or Luxembourg. People invest in Scotland because we have a brilliant, creative, innovative workforce. Scotland does not, the success of Scotland does not depend on Brussels. Now, I know that for many, the EU means outward-looking, engaged, internationalist politics. And I like that too. I love Europe. But Europe and the EU are two different things. Trading with the EU and unconditional acceptance of single market obligations are two different things. I believe that we can create a Scotland within a UK that has global ambitions and relationships. I believe in the union between our great countries, one United Kingdom. And what I need right now is a Scottish government that rolls up its sleeves and gets on with building a strong Scottish economy, not one that threatens its success with its never-ending rhetoric on independence. And I sincerely hope that Mr. Russell is willing to negotiate with the interests of all Scotland in mind, not just the interests of the SNP.
Thank you very much. Mary Evans, we're followed by Ross Greer. Ms. Evans, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Now, while the ramifications of Brexit aren't fully known yet, an area where the Brexit vote is starting to have a visible repercussions and a very real impact is in local government. particularly in relation to funding, and that's the element that I would like to focus on today, as it's already been touched on by Claire Hoy. Now, local authorities are responsible for the delivery of one-third of Scotland's allocation of EU structural funds, and it's that funding alongside the transnational funds which is an immediate concern. Now, without wanting to dwell too much on the debate, the referendum debate itself and the arguments put forward on both sides, one element I felt was missing was the extent to which the EU funding underpins a huge number of local projects and the impact of these funds locally and nationally. Local authorities, alongside community planning partners, universities and colleges, rely on EU support to deliver work in vital areas: research and development, business support, employability, economic development, tourism, support for small and medium enterprises, rural development, community work, tackling poverty. So what are these funds and what do they mean on the ground? There's the European Regional Development Fund and the European Social Fund, which fund employability programmes and business gateway activity, where ERDF funds enable additional business support to be delivered. There's the Leader Rural Development Programme and European Maritime and Fisheries Fund, worth £2.7 million to Angus and £2.8 million to South Aberdeenshire, both in my constituency, and community-led. So far, they've helped to fund community hubs, tourism activities, as well as the innovative crowdfunder project in Angus, which has been the first of its kind anywhere else in the UK. Then we have the transnational funds. Those funds over and above what we get back from the EU as net contributors. Erasmus, Horizon 2020, Interreg, Creative Europe and COSME have also played a huge role locally and to our colleges and universities. Just to give you an idea of some of the values and projects involved in some of those funds. In the last programming period, Dundee University was involved in over 20 research projects and had secured €65 million worth of funding, as well as an additional €5 million for the small and medium enterprises involved. This last year alone, yes.
Mr. Tompkins.
I'm very grateful to Mary Evans for giving way. Would the member not accept that a country does not have to be a member state of the European Union to have access to these funds and participate in these programmes? Indeed, Turkish universities participate in these programmes.
Ms. Evans.
The member is absolutely right. But until we know exactly what position we're going to be in, well, we don't know what the answer to that is going to be. Now, this last year alone, the university, Dundee University secured Horizon 2020 funding to the value of £7.6 million. These funds have also allowed extensive investment in renewables and carbon reduction programmes, Aberdeen hydrogen buses being one example. But what these figures don't include is the other investment this funding brings in, and that is when the amounts become staggering. I chaired the East of Scotland European Consortium until being elected to the Parliament earlier this year, an organisation which represents eight local authorities across the east coast of Scotland, aiming to influence EU policy affecting our region and looking for further European funding opportunities. The combined total of projects in just four of these local authorities, including the private and public monies levered in on the back of the EU grant funding, was worth £383,235,000, and that's in the last funding period. And that's just the four local authorities that I happen to have the figures for. I'm short for time. Aberdeen has been a particular beneficiary, at one point the biggest recipient of one of those transnational funds in the whole of the UK. So what does the uncertainty of that funding now mean? That there is a reticence on behalf of local authorities to develop new projects, as well as a reticence on behalf of EU partners to take part in projects with a UK partner. Because of the lead-in and decision time taken for some funds, local authorities are deciding they can't take the risk to bid. The Interreg Fund, for example, which funds transnational cooperation, can take up to a year from the point of application to final decision. Already, anecdotally, UK partners are not being considered for these transnational programmes. At this moment, there is absolutely no guarantee that anything will replace EU funds, and as we all know, there are quite a few bids in for the £350 million a week that we're apparently going to have. I don't have time. While we know that committed projects such as those through LEADER, vital for our rural communities, will continue to be funded, many local authority areas across Scotland are only just getting these funds off the ground and operational. EU funds, by their very nature, are designed to provide added value, focus on key themes and those areas that are not covered by domestic funding. Without the investment from the current allocated funds, If they are halted or completely withdrawn, there will be a serious detrimental impact both locally and nationally. Without assurances for funding beyond the next couple of years, and without knowing if these areas will be specifically ring-fenced or protected, we're in very real danger of doing extensive damage to our national and local economy and ultimately on the people living in our local communities. I hope I've managed to convey the scope and scale of what that impact might be. The Scottish Government is doing everything within its power to reassure, but there's only so much the Government here can do when we still have no idea what the negotiating position of the UK Government is going to be and if Scotland's voice will indeed be heard in that. Brexit may well mean Brexit, but until we know what that means, the uncertainty and the damage that is doing is set to continue.
Thank you. Paul Ross Good, followed by Tavish Scott.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Yet again, we find ourselves in a strange position in this debate. We are not quite a full player, though I expect today this Parliament will once again assert our right to play a full and significant role in the process, but nor are we observers commenting from the stands while two teams go head-to-head in front of us. And the situation itself is far from simple. In so many ways, things have moved very quickly indeed in the last few weeks. Events are progressing and the key players are becoming clear. And yet we're not fundamentally any further forward. Article 50 will not be activated anytime soon. And that's probably a good thing for the UK, given that the Westminster government seems no closer to deciding what Brexit actually means. All the while, European institutions are preparing a team which in every way outclasses Theresa May's three Brexiteer ministers. And Scotland's position has certainly become no clearer. For those of us determined to follow the mandate of our own electorate and ensure that our future is within the European Union, the fight is still very much on. And despite the chaos at Westminster, with ministers repeatedly making statements which the government then has to walk back as nothing more than a personal opinion, there are some positive developments. Guy Verhofstadt, the European Parliament's newly appointed Brexit negotiator, is certainly a fan of ours, having repeatedly made positive statements about the options for Scotland to preserve our European Union membership, our relationship with the Union. Of course, the same Guy Verhofstadt is also very clear on a few things that Westminster cabinet ministers seem to be struggling with. Just last night, he confirmed that access to the single market means freedom of movement. The two are inseparable, as has been already covered in this debate. And he is not the first senior European figure to issue such a clarification. Yes.
Adam Tomkins.
If he's right about that, how can he explain the position of Liechtenstein, which is a full member of the EEA but has a cap on inward European migration?
Ross Greer.
I don't think Liechtenstein's position is particularly comparable to Scotland, given the significant differences between those two states. But he is not the only senior European figure to have made this point. German Chancellor Angela Merkel, the President of the European Commission, Jean-Claude Juncker, have all made the same point. The United Kingdom is throwing away goodwill with our European partners through being unable to define a negotiating position, through taking a belligerent attitude, and through appointing ministers who simply are not informed enough about the situation. The Westminster government must, as a starting point, accept that single market access is essential and that being part of the single market means all four freedoms. It would be a monumental act of economic self-sabotage to do otherwise, though otherwise does seem to be the preferred option of David Davis and Liam Fox. Their very opposition to the European Union, their Leave vote, was motivated by an isolationist anti-free movement feeling. Freedom of movement is an economic necessity for the people they represent, though. The net benefit of non-UK EU citizens in 2013-14 was £2.5 billion. It's particularly essential for Scotland, where an ageing population and relatively high rates of emigration mean that we have welcomed with open arms those from the rest of the continent and beyond who have decided to live, work or study here. But freedom of movement is not just an economic tool. It is a statement of our principles, of what kind of Europe we want to be and what we want to see as the purpose of the European project. To break down barriers between nations, to assert that there's much more in common between Europeans, between all peoples, than that which divides us. Yes.
Neil Findlay.
Does he accept that for many workers, they have come here not through choice, but they've been driven here by low pay and poor opportunities in their homeland?
Ross Greer.
Mr. Finlay's clearly seen sight of my speech in advance. That is the very next section of it. The single market and the European project as a whole have considerable flaws, not least amongst them the dominance of huge economic forces, which are the major influence in where and why people move around this continent. Freedom of movement is a principle, but it has absolutely been exploited by the capitalist powers across this continent. But a hard Brexit, defaulting to World Trade Organization rules, is simply not tolerable. It is a line that I believe Scotland is not willing to cross. And I would encourage the Scottish Government to maintain a negotiation position which values free movement of all people, and to prevent the UK Government at every opportunity from negotiating a deal which puts the freedom of big business above the freedom of all of our citizens. Faced with a situation where any of these options do come to pass, I believe the case for a second referendum on our independence is a hard one to reject. Recent events have shown in the bluntest of terms the need for the people of Scotland to put our own future in our own hands, to have our own seat at the European table, and to escape the disaster zone of Westminster politics. The Conservative amendment to this debate and their party line on Brexit shows heads firmly stuck in the sand on this point. It is not possible to say that the votes of 2014 and 2016 can both stand when they are now contradictory. The United Kingdom, with its guaranteed European Union membership that Scotland voted for in 2014, simply no longer exists. And it may yet come to pass that satisfactory arrangements for Scotland inside the UK, whilst maintaining a strong relationship with Europe, are not possible. Our electorate will have voted for two unions, but will probably, in time, quite soon, have to choose between them. For now, though, we do remain a member of the European Union, and the ongoing discussion should not stop us from continuing to build relationships with our European partners. Quite the opposite. This standstill, created by the UK Government, offers us an opportunity to demonstrate our commitment to Europe. The Government, Civic Scotland, we all must emphasise our commonality and our shared future. Rather than pulling up the drawbridge, the time is now to explore and enhance our relationships with the rest of the European Union. That is what the people of Scotland voted for, it is what this Parliament voted for, and it is what I expect us to do.
Tavish Scott, to be followed by Alex Neil.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Let me start by welcoming Michael Russell to his position as Scotland's leading diplomat. Although I hope he'll take this in a cheerful fashion, my understanding and recognition of Mr. Russell's diplomacy over the years is that as long as you agree with him, he's Scotland's leading diplomat. But that may be precisely why he's been appointed to this job. And I also suspect he'll be doing this for some considerable time to come, because this is not this will not be a quick process. This is going to take many, many, many years. Indeed, Mr. Russell may be looking for re-election and still be doing this job in 5 years' time. We have embarked on something we simply don't know where it will end or when it will end. And possibly Mr. Russell could start in the course of many busy days, including London tomorrow, by speaking to Ken Clark. I thought I'd reintroduce Ken Clark to European debate, because it always so cheers up the Conservative benches when you mention him. Ken Clark said this week, "None of the Brexiteers at the moment have any clear idea of what they want to do next by way of actual change to our economy, trade, migration and other arrangements with the EU. A flood of legislation and regulations will probably have to be put before Parliament over the next few years implementing changes." Well, that is indeed so. And if the Conservative benches, or more to the point, the Conservative Party, had listened to Ken Clark a little bit more over the years on Europe, we'd be in a rather better situation. I have to also say to the many interventions from my good friend Professor Adam Tompkins, this is not going to be about constitutional law. It's not going to be about the great issues of the Constitution. It's going to be about politics. It's just simple as that. And that's why I want to take up Neil Findlay's very fair challenge to all of us who are on the pro-European side. I wouldn't necessarily go with Neil Findlay's analysis on everything, but he has every right to set out why those of us who do believe in the EU and the need to reform it, the very questions he set out from Calmac retendering onwards, why we need to do exactly that. And I just want to introduce one or two points that I do think are relevant in that wider context, because on Friday, the first European summit will take place, heads of government summit will take place without a British Prime Minister since the stages that Michael Russell was talking about in his opening remarks. Now, that in itself is a pretty staggering state of affairs. Yesterday, Donald Tusk, the chair of the European Council, said the institutions, by which he meant the European institutions, the Commission, should support the priorities as agreed by among member states, not support their own ones. And that is at the heart of what is wrong at the moment with the European Union. There is, and has been for many years, too much flow from the centre. Fishing is but one example, and not enough from the member states. And frankly, at the moment, the European Union has lost the member states. And that, there is no better illustration of that than the Visegrad 4, Hungary, Poland, Slovakia, and the Czech Republic, who want a looser EU. It wasn't that long ago, and some of us might have been involved in a margins of politics at that time, when the two-stage Europe was described. The difference between those at the centre, France and Germany, led by Delors and others, who wanted to push forward a full federalist EU, compared to many on the outside of Europe as they saw it, Finland and many other Scandinavian nations, including the UK, who did not see the advantages of that kind of approach. I suspect we are back into that, and some of Mr. Russell's considerations in the coming years, not certainly for today, but in the coming years, will be to consider how best we are in that reformed and changing European Union. Because for those who say we must stay in the EU, come what may, I'm just not sure I can answer the question, what will the EU actually look like in 5 years' time? There are also 15 elections in member states over the next 2 years, never mind what will happen both in Germany and in France next year. This is not in any way a set story. And in that context, the biggest challenges for the European Union, not what we may think in Edinburgh or even more so in London, they are about security after Nice, Paris and Brussels. They are about the refugee crisis, and they are about that thing that never gets mentioned these days, the Euro crisis and the financial weakness therein. So reform must happen. And so it must happen in domestic sense, as Stuart Stevenson rightly said, and in others, I shared those remarks about fishing. I hope the cabinet secretary, the minister on the front bench will accept that from his own constituency point of view as well. We cannot have a repeat of the common fisheries policy. It must change. And whatever happens in the coming years, it must change very significantly indeed. And the SFF briefing set to members set that out very clearly yesterday. Can I finally say, Deputy Presiding Officer, that while I always enjoy Jackson Carlaw's contributions to this chamber, it is not for the rest of us to take a contribution on Europe and a lecture on Europe from the Conservatives. The reason we had the June the 23rd referendum was not about the future of the United Kingdom and was about the future of David Cameron and the Conservatives. And it really is time they showed a little humble pie on those benches and let the rest of us sort out our future, because sure as heck the Conservatives will not do that.
Alex Neil to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thank you very much indeed, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I begin by publicly welcoming and congratulating Mike Russell to his new job? As a former colleague in Cabinet, I can say that he's been an outstanding minister in every job he's done, and I'm absolutely sure he'll continue with that success, provided, of course, he follows my advice. Yeah, yeah. Can I say it's time we had honest realism in the Brexit debate? And if I may say so, my old school Air Academy, its motto was respicky, prospicky. Respicky, look backward, prospicky, look forward. Unfortunately, there's too much respicky in this debate and not enough prospicky. Too much re-arguing the debate that led up to the referendum on the 23rd of June. What the challenge is before us now is, where do we go from here? How do we deal with the hand that we have been given as a result of the Brexit decision by the UK people? And we've got to be very clear-headed. And there's some muddled thinking in this chamber, not just today, but last week, for example. Kezia Dugdale demanded that the First Minister secure Scotland's place in the European Union and that she meet governments around the world to seek a means of retaining our EU membership. Presiding Officer, this is an absurd statement, especially coming from such an arch-unionist as Ms. Dugdale. Does she not realise that a decision has been made by the UK state that she wanted to keep us in, to stay in the European Union? And as long as Scotland is a member of that state, we are obliged also to accept that democratic decision.
Lewis MacDonald.
I'm grateful to Mr. Neil for accepting an intervention. Does he recall the mandate given to the Scottish Government by this Parliament, which was precisely to seek means to protect Scotland's relationship with the European Union and to protect our place in the European single market?
Alex Neil.
There's a very big difference between protecting the relationship with the European Union and saying that we can retain our membership. And there's also the small point that we cannot retain membership for Scotland because we're not a member. You can only retain something if you've already got it. We are not the member state. The UK is the member state. So a little reality coming into this debate would be very useful. Now, these comments, I think, show the muddled thinking on some benches, particularly, if I may say so, amongst the unionist parties. The challenge now is to ensure that we make the best for Scotland of Brexit, not trying to kid people on that we can turn the clock back to the way things were prior to the 23rd of June. We have to stop refighting the EU referendum arguments. That debate is over. Our entire focus must be on what do we do to plan for life outside membership of the European Union. And that's why I will vote for the government motion tonight, although I have one, well, in a minute, I have one little criticism I've already mentioned to the Minister privately, and that's the inclusion of the words which say Scotland's best interests are best served within the UK. That implies that we could still be within the UK, and I don't accept that we can. The decision has been taken. We must now move on.
Neil Findlay.
Could I offer Mr. Neil a deal? If he gets his party to stop refighting the independence referendum, I'll appeal to everybody else to stop refighting the EU referendum. How about it?
Alex Neil.
I would count my fingers before I did a deal with Neil Findlay on anything. Now, the position, I think, across the whole chamber is that we all agree, and there is a distinction between Europe and the European Union. The European Union is part of Europe, but it does not equate to Europe. Now, we are a European nation, and we must build on being a European nation. But we're not going to be in the EU, but what we want is close, good, working, trading, economic, social, and political relationships with the EU after Brexit. And I believe the Scottish Government should concentrate on three key demands, which embrace the principles announced by the First Minister. The first one, I think, in which there is broad agreement, and I've chosen my words carefully, is to ensure that we continue to enjoy uninterrupted access to the benefits of the European single market. The second one is to ensure that as many as possible of the powers to be repatriated from Brussels to the UK are transferred to this Parliament as they relate to Scotland. Those powers shouldn't just relate to policy areas already devolved to Scotland. They should include, for example, powers over immigration and value-added tax. We were promised by the UK Leave campaign that if the UK left the EU, then Scotland would get control or some control over immigration. That promise now has to be delivered as part of the Brexit process. We need new immigration powers so we can adopt an immigration policy suited to the needs of Scotland, just as the City of London is already demanding similar powers for similar reasons, namely to help grow a skilled workforce and thereby improve our levels of economic growth. And similarly, the Treasury excuse the EU rules wouldn't allow us to devolve VAT power to Scotland will no longer be valid. We should get those powers. I've given up my 6 minutes. Unfortunately, I had much more to say, but I'll save that for another day, Presiding Officer. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Neil. Can I have Colin Smith to be followed by Ash Denham? Up to 5 minutes, please, Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin by declaring an interest as a councillor in Dumfries and Galloway? As we've heard throughout today's debate, all members agree that the result of the EU referendum will have a significant impact in all our communities, and my own South Scotland constituency is no different. Our internationally trading businesses are left uncertain over whether they'll be able to continue to access a meaningful single market. Key industries across South Scotland, particularly agriculture and hospitality, wonder what will happen to many of their current and potentially future workers if we no longer have freedom of movement. And those workers themselves, our neighbours or friends, are left in limbo, wondering what the future holds for them and their families. Our universities are left questioning where future grants may come from if they no longer receive EU research funding. And many of our third sector organisations, heavily reliant on EU funding streams, fear that even temporary gaps between funding cycles could force many to cease operations entirely. And it's on the issue of European funding that I want to focus most of my comments in this debate. As members will know, Scotland has benefited from a range of European funds for more than four decades. In South Scotland, the largest proportion of that funding comes through the Common Agricultural Policy. Last year, nearly £150 million came into Dumfries and Galloway and the Scottish Borders alone through Pillar 1 and Pillar 2 payments, funding that is vital to the viability of the agricultural sector in South Scotland. As Mary Evans highlighted earlier, there are also payments made through both the European Regional Development Fund, a crucial funding stream for supporting businesses, and the European Social Fund, which helps to support local councils' employability programmes in many of our constituencies. European funding supports important rural community and business projects through LEADER, which currently has funding in Dumfries and Galloway and the Scottish Borders close to £10 million over the duration of the programme. The European Maritime and Fisheries Fund also provides important funding to businesses and community groups in coastal areas. And of course, there are many national programmes that cover South Scotland, supported by European funding, delivered by Skills Development Scotland, Scottish Enterprise, Visit Scotland, the Scottish Funding Council, all of which will be affected by Brexit. But despite these crucial funding streams, until now, South Scotland hasn't necessarily received its fair share of funding. Without wishing to bore members too much with the technical detail, and I don't think that will be easy, but the existing statistical boundaries, the so-called nuts areas used by the EU for regional policy purposes, currently combines the Scottish Borders with urban areas in the east and Dumfries and Galloway with urban areas in the west. These combinations mask the significant economic challenges the more rural south of Scotland faces, and as a result of the current nuts area combination, the region receives a lower level of European funding than those challenges merit. That's why for some time stakeholders in South Scotland, in particular the South of Scotland Alliance, have been developing a proposal to create a fifth South of Scotland Nuts 2 area. That area would include mainland North, South and East Ayrshire, South Lanarkshire, Dumfries and Galloway and the Scottish Borders. Earlier this year the Scottish Government backed this proposal and their recommendation was passed by the UK Government's Office of National Statistics to the European Commission. This was accepted by the European Statistical System Committee in May 2016. The proposed new South of Scotland nuts area showed that GDP in the region is around £17,000, just 70% of the EU average. That economic indicator would have meant that when it comes to the next round of European funding, a new South of Scotland nuts 2 area could have secured tens of millions of pounds of extra funding. So although there is a great deal of uncertainty currently in relation to Brexit, it's probably safe to say that whatever the outcome of negotiations, there is unlikely to be a continuation of the EU's structural and investment funding as far as the UK is concerned. This means that any current funding levels will likely cease, and the potential benefits which changes to Nuts 2 boundaries would have brought to the south of Scotland will now not materialise. But in preparation for the eventual Brexit, the UK and Scottish governments will need to put in place policy measures which will, to an extent, replicate the support provided under current EU policy. Given that Scottish ministers backed the proposal for a South of Scotland Nuts 2 area, I would ask them to continue that backing in the years ahead. That means when negotiating with the UK government and developing future support to replace EU funding, the Scottish government do not simply aim to protect the current level of funding received from the EU, but follow through on their support for a South of Scotland Nuts 2 area and ensure additional regional development funding for that region. There is a reason why Southern Scotland has a low GDP, and if the Scottish Government are serious about delivering on their commitment to regional cohesion and their economic strategy, tackling that low level of GDP is vital.
Ash Denham, followed by Alexander Stewart.
Before I start, I'd like to put on the record that the First Minister has appointed me as Political Liaison Officer to the Culture and External Affairs portfolio. I represent an Edinburgh constituency, home to a varied mix of people, including many EU nationals who work in our capital. And some of them have been moved to write to me over the last couple of months regarding our exit from the EU, and I thought it might be instructive to hear from them in this debate. One wrote, "My partner is a German citizen, but grew up in Greece, and our baby son is a dual national, so thankfully he will always be a European citizen. The Leave vote threatens my partner's right to work, my right to travel, and our son's future." Another wrote, "My family is working hard. We're not taking any benefits. We're independent and professional people. Surely we are all one Europe where people's rights are respected." And another wrote to me, "I've lived in Scotland for over 10 years. I'm an employer with a small business. Overnight, I found my whole life had been thrown up in the air. The Brexit vote and the fallout from it have frankly been quite shocking. I found it hard to believe that the Leave campaign won, but I found it even harder to believe that not a single politician, with the exception of Nicola Sturgeon, had a contingency plan." Mm-hmm. Constituents of all ages, in many different jobs, from business owners, academics, scientists, and chefs, have contacted me, shocked and afraid. And this is the human face behind Theresa May's statement that there will be no guarantees for EU nationals. These are law-abiding citizens, taxpayers, and committed members of their communities, people with businesses, people with employees that depend upon them, people with mortgages, children in school, homes. It is unacceptable that the UK government could leave this issue dragging on unresolved for the next 2 years. EU nationals living here deserve some certainty. These are people with lives and not political bargaining chips. Brexit negotiations will be lengthy and they will be complex, and those that say otherwise are doing the public a great disservice. Jürgen Hart, a lawmaker who speaks on foreign policy matters for Merkel's Christian Democrats, thinks that Britain should not expect special treatment on a halt to immigration. He said there's no possibility to, for example, abridge the free movement of employees, but keep all the other freedoms that EU members share within the single market. Merkel and others in her government have repeatedly warned that Germany won't let the UK pick and choose EU benefits once the exit clause is triggered. German Foreign Minister Frank-Walter Steinmeier joined Hart in saying that the EU benefits come at a cost. He said the UK can't rid itself of duties of an EU member and at the same time keep the rights of an EU member. And he said we need to talk about this with more clarity on both sides of the English Channel. There will be two strands to the negotiations. The ones to leave the EU, which may well be concluded within the 2 years after Article 50 is triggered. But the other strand, that of trade deals that are going to replace it, these negotiations, in my opinion, will not. And many experts are now suggesting that these could take up to a decade to conclude. So what are other people saying about this? Well, Theresa Villiers, MP, has said, "We can be certain that the dire predictions of the Remain campaign have not come to pass, and I don't believe they will in the future." John Redwood, MP, said, "I see no circumstances where the Brexit vote can cause a recession in the UK. But let us be clear, Brexit has not happened yet. The full impact for our economy, for EU citizens and their rights, and even more things than that are yet to come, and we don't know what they are. Whilst these senior Tories are making what will no doubt turn out to be premature pronouncements, the economic implications for Scotland, and let us remember that Scotland did not vote for, could be bleak. In a recent report, the Fraser Allender Institute forecast that the rate of growth in the Scottish economy will experience a sharp slowdown over the next 3 years as a result of the decision to leave the EU. They state, the degree of impact will depend upon the nature of the revised trading agreement. Remaining in the single market is clearly a top priority, as it will minimise the degree of dislocation. But even then, Brexit will have a detrimental effect on growth. However, if limiting free movement is a key plank of the UK's negotiating stance, which we believe it will be, the Institute and others have noted that securing a deal on access to the single market without freedom of movement is highly improbable. As it stands, there is no formal intergovernmental structure in place to govern the involvement of the Scottish Government during this process. Scotland should be at the table through all the stages of negotiation, from the consultation stage that we're in at the moment, through the details of the deal, and then on to the implementation. Scotland must be allowed to be fully involved
Please
in order
close, Ms. Denham.
To protect Scotland's interests. Theresa May must be held to her commitment to have Scottish engagement, and that engagement must not be limited only to
Please
a brief
close,
consultation
Ms.
at the beginning and no meaningful input thereafter.
Alexander Stewart, followed by Stuart McMillan. Up to 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On the 23rd of June, the people of the United Kingdom made a choice to leave the political structures of the European Union and forge new, dynamic and bold relationships with both Europe and the rest of the world. I, for one, was one Scot who chose to go down that route, along with 17.5 million people in Britain, and I look forward to the new relationships that we can forge in that opportunity. The opportunities for Scotland and the United Kingdom that now present themselves as we look beyond the European horizons are, Presiding Officer, immense. Now we can begin to form a new trading relationship with growing markets while continuing to emerge and do all the business we can with our friends on the continent. Since we joined the European Common Market, the world has changed. In 1980, the member state of the European Economic Community accounted for 30% of the world's GDP. And now, despite additions of new members, the European Union makes up only 16.5% of the world's output. Of the United Kingdom's 10 biggest non-EU trading partners, the European Union currently only free trade agreements with two of them. We are moving forward in the world with multilateral trade, and we want to ensure that we can do as much as we can within our country here to do all we can to ensure that we do the best for the communities that we represent. Indeed, focusing on the trade blocks that we have, we now have opportunities to be much more international in approach and the businesses that we have. The SNP, however, have unsurprisingly sought to use the referendum result to fuel their ambition for a separate Scotland, and I, Presiding Officer, unequivocally accept the fact that the majority of Scots voted to remain within the European Union, but this was a decision taken by the United Kingdom as a member state, and the decision gave each and every member one single equal vote in the process. Our new Prime Minister has made it absolutely clear that she and others will take the views of Scotland into account going forward, and that we would expect to take place. I welcome the appointment of Mike Russell as the Minister for the UK negotiations. I have no doubt that he will take that role on, as he's done in the past, and be a very positive process in moving forward. We in the Scottish Conservative and Unionist Party shall play our part in this process. And Ruth Davison on Monday made an announcement that she will take together an advisory group that will consult on the impact of Brexit on Scotland. And both myself and Adam Tomkinson will play a part in that, along with other experts from other fields across Scotland. The Nationalists have never ceased to speak of their desire for more powers to be devolved to this place and for more decisions to be taken in Scotland. But in this particular case, they seem to do all they want to do is to prevent any more powers coming to Holyrood. As a result of these new powers and the model which we will operate and the powers that we have, it's very clear, Presiding Officer, that within the format of the EU that we have, we will have major opportunities. We in this chamber should rise to the challenge and look at the new innovation that will take place as we move forward, rather than being stuck with the Brexit diktat. There is no doubt that there's a time of change, and within change, that leaves uncertainty. But, Presiding Officer, there is no doubt otherwise that our First Minister has ensured that she has altered the process, and she's been a little bit posturing when she says what's happening as we move forward. And that has been unhelpful. And as we move forward, it has been chosen to do that so that we can take away and a smokescreen can appear to mask the failures of what's happening here in Scotland. Scotland's trading relationship with the United Kingdom is 4 times the size of our trading relationship with the EU. Coupled with the latest government expenditure and Review Scotland figures to suggest that an independent Scotland would face a 15 billion black hole. This separation has to be looked at. In concluding, Presiding Officer, I greatly anticipate the optimistic approach that we are taking here in Scotland and look forward to the European Union becoming much more for all of us in the opportunities that we have, the contributions that we make, and the values that we see here. So we need to all step up to the mark and seize the opportunities on the new powers that our trading relationship will present us. And I look forward to being part of that process as we move forward, Deputy Presiding Officer. Thank you.
We now move to the last of the open speeches, and that's Stuart McMillan. Definitely no longer than 5 minutes, please, Mr. McMillan.
Okay. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. First of all, I welcome Mike Russell to his role, his new ministerial role, and I wish him every success. But before I actually start with the speech, I just want to touch upon one point that Alexander Stewart just spoke about there, and that was about powers to come to Scotland. Can he tell the Chamber what new powers are going to come to Scotland with Brexit? No?
Alexander Stewart.
Agriculture and fisheries are areas that we should be looking at and can make great capital from.
Stuart McMillan.
Can Mr. Stewart actually guarantee they will come to this Parliament, or is it just a bit of assertion from the Conservative Party because of the mess that they've actually taken the UK into? Presiding Officer, I certainly was hoping that by this time we would actually have a better appreciation of what Brexit actually means, and we've just heard from Mr. Stewart that clearly there is no idea whatsoever. Unfortunately, we are no further forward, and the lack of clarity on the issue, aligned to the ever-growing sense of confusion at UK level, will only increase economic uncertainty across these islands. And at Prime Minister's questions only last week, the Prime Minister refused twice to answer the very simple but crucial question on UK membership of the European single market. Now, the EU is the biggest trading bloc in the world, and that's why it's so important to businesses and the economy, not just in Scotland, but certainly across the UK. But the situation last week, that followed the farce of our own Brexit Secretary, David Davis, suggesting that the UK staying in a single market was very improbable, only the next day for Downing Street to tell us that he was actually expressing a personal opinion. Presiding Officer, I recognise that the Brexit position we now face is challenging to manoeuvre through, but as the First Minister said today in the European and External Relations Committee, that during the Scottish independence referendum, she was continually being asked for a plan A, a plan B, a plan C, right to a plan Z. But certainly, we know that this Tory UK government don't even have a plan A, never mind anything else. Now, I accept that the Conservatives were divided on the issue of Brexit, some for Remain and also some for Leave, but they now appear to be gathering around the one position of making Brexit work. Now, that's a position I think most people can accept to be a reasonable position. However, Presiding Officer, without a clear pathway to actually what Brexit means, what will it deliver for Scotland, and what will it deliver for my constituency of Greenock and Inverclyde? Now, the negotiations are absolutely crucial to what's going on over the course of the next months and years ahead. Undoubtedly, some Tory politicians are staying silent because it's clear that Brexit is making the UK smaller. Japan, Australia and the USA are now on record as saying that the UK will go to the back of the queue for trade deals and that their economic focus will lie elsewhere. And before the EU referendum, we were promised that leaving would free the UK from Brussels red tape, to quote one example among many. Yet it now looks as if that new trade deals will actually result in significantly more red tape for British companies exporting to the EU, as British exporters may have to obtain proof. I only have 5 minutes, I'm sorry. We have to obtain proof of origin certificates from the National Customs Authorities, certificates that could increase trade costs with the EU by between 4% and 15%. Now, we cannot strike agreements with 50 countries currently covered by EU arrangements until we strike a trade deal with the EU, because everyone else will want to know where we stand. Now, it could take years before the UK can strike a new trade deal with the EU. Now, how many jobs will be lost to foreign investors, driven away in the process, is a subject the Prime Minister really needs to start talking about and thinking about. Now, furthermore, Presiding Officer, no one knows how long the Brexit scenario is going to last for. We've already heard about 10 years been spoken of, and I've also heard up to 20 years because of the level of secondary legislation that's going to be required to be dealt with. And Brexit will certainly create an opportunity. And we heard about opportunities from Jamie Green. It will certainly create an opportunity for those in the legal profession, those who work in European law. That is going to be a booming sector in the years to come. Now, in my closing comments, Presiding Officer, I want to touch upon education, Erasmus schemes. When I was doing my honours degree, I studied through the Socrates Erasmus scheme. And I did my master's, I qualify for some European Social Fund money. Now, Jamie Green spoke about opportunities and about the opportunity of Brexit that it provides. Now, I studied in France, Germany and Sweden as a proud European. Now, the opportunity that the free movement of people provide me is something that I don't want to see ended. I don't want to bring up the ladder behind me and to prevent others from actually having that opportunity to go and study abroad. Now, I'm quite sure that we are trying to encourage more people to go to university, particularly those from communities that are considered to be deprived. Now, I am not going to be one of those people who actually wants to prevent those individuals from having that opportunity to go and study abroad. I don't know about Conservatives, but I'm not one of those people. Now, the financial costs, the additional financial costs and burdens that may be placed upon people from deprived communities may well be that they will stop that opportunity and not stop thinking about going to study. But, Mr. Presiding Officer, in closing, although the EU is not perfect, it is an opportunity provider. Thank you very much.
Yeah, you were cutting it a bit fine there, Mr. McMillan. We now move to the closing speeches. And can I call on Daniel Johnson? Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Brexit means Brexit, much as biscuit means biscuit. Now, Mary Berry may be stunned at her relevance to such matters of state, but in the week that we've learned of its split from the BBC, the bake-off has surely taught us something. A biscuit may undoubtedly be a biscuit, but that tells you nothing about its type, its flavour, its size, whether it will delight or disappoint, or whether it snaps or is simply soggy. And the same is true for our future constitutional settlement, because Brexit means Brexit, sure. But what type and what quality are we getting? I'm glad I've brought some humour and mirth to the chamber. The First Minister described Brexit means Brexit as meaningless tautology, but I would go further. Brexit means Brexit is dangerous spin. Since the result of the 24th of June, we have had a summer of obfuscation, leaving the direction of the UK government intends to take extremely unclear. This is serious because the implications of the nature of our future relationship with Europe are measured in jobs, from manufacturing jobs that rely on selling our goods to the EU, to academics whose research funding is now uncertain, to the jobs in finance, insurance and law that rely on passporting rights to the rest of Europe. We need to know what sort of relationship the UK seeks with the EU and what kind of Brexit it means. But the SNP have similar questions to answer. What do they see as the future of Scotland? And forgive me if I'm not clear on their position, because at the beginning of the summer, a second referendum on independence was highly likely, but then it became an option. And more recently, there seems to be an offer of support to Tory ministers who want a soft Brexit. And on the single market, the SNP haven't been consistent on whether they are more concerned on membership or access, although Mr. Neil seems to be clarifying that position for them. Neither government can hide behind the veil of negotiating position, because you need to... I can understand why the detail of what the government seeks cannot be revealed in advance, but it is vital that we understand the broad outcomes and the overall shape and nature of the future deal that we aim for. Let me put it this way. If you're buying a car, you certainly don't tell the salesman how much money you have in your budget and what you might accept in terms of free servicing, but it tends to be a good idea to tell him what car you're wanting to buy in the first place. So we need to know what access to the single market means. Oh, well, how could I refuse an intervention from Mr. Carlow?
Jackson Carlow.
Having spent 30 years in the retail motor industry, can I assure Mr. Johnson what the customer can afford is absolutely crucial when they're buying a car? Yeah.
Daniel Johnson.
Well, the customer is always right, and I'm sure no one ever walked off your car lot disappointed, Mr. Carlow. But let me summarise the debate, and we've had a number of, I think, very good interventions and contributions. And I think in some ways, to my mind, it is perhaps best summed up by Joan McAlpine, who point out the contradictions we've had from Conservative ministers in London, such as confusion from David Mundell to David Davis having to be reined in. We did indeed have a promise in July of a joined-up UK position, and we need far greater clarity on the fundamentals, such as the single market and free movement of people. But I am also disappointed, and I think by the way that this debate has been introduced by both Mr. Russell and Mr. Carlow, because we started with history lessons, and then we moved very quickly on to wheeling out the constitutional artillery. So let me say this to both governments, both Edinburgh government and London government. We need clarity from the UK on the objectives and what it is the government seeks, but we need clarity from the Scottish government on what its minimum outcomes are, because we can have no more rattling of the possibility of future independence referendums with vague outlines of rationales and triggers of what might bring that about. Because the reality is that there is a cost of that uncertainty. And it is, as I said earlier, measured in jobs. And we have already seen the decline of foreign direct investment to Scotland and a decline in investment in property in this country. And we can afford that no longer. But I also would like to just highlight the points that my friend Mr. Finlay raised about we cannot have an uncritical dialogue about the future of the EU. There are 38% of our fellow Scots who feel left behind, and we have to address those issues. And indeed, I think it highlights the nature of this as well. We may be focused on the European debate now. We have to focus on the realities of the real important issues of housing, jobs, and the future for all Scots. I would also just like to mention Claire Haughey, Mary Evans and Colin Smith, who I think were right to point out issues such as the years it will take to develop future trade deals with other countries and the uncertainty and the real cost that's already bringing in areas such as university research funding. I would also finally like to comment on Mr. Neil's contributions. And I have to say I was interested in what he analysed membership to mean, because that was not quite what I remember membership of the European Union being discussed 2 years ago. And I think he was also right to set the challenge to his own government of looking at what repatriation might mean and to ask that we get on with that preparation. This country faces Brexit, at least in part because of a lack of clarity. Those of us who believe in Europe fail to be clear about why it was important for jobs and prosperity. Those who argue to leave fail to establish a clear alternative. Let's put an end to that clarity. Let's seek the assurances. Let's have those assurances for both the UK and Scottish governments so we know what Brexit really means. Thank you.
Adam Tomkins, no more than 8 minutes, please. Mr.
No more than 9 minutes, presiding
officer. No more than 8 minutes, please, Mr. Tomkins. In fact, I think I said no more than seven.
I haven't been in politics very long, Deputy Presiding Officer, but it's already beginning to surprise me, and I never thought I would open a speech in this chamber with these words, but I agreed with a great deal of what Alex Neil had to say, although I suspect that we voted on opposite sides in both of the last two referendums. In particular, I agreed with what he said about how there is a great deal in this chamber of muddy thinking about the EU and Scotland's relationship with it, including, I'm afraid, muddy thinking by my friend, the Minister. Who doesn't seem to be able to understand the difference between Europe and the European Union. And Scotland's relationship with Europe, Scotland's identity as a European nation, neither began with the European Communities Act 1972, nor will it end with Brexit in 2016. So let me try and bring some clarity to the debate. Scotland voted on the 23rd of June that the United Kingdom should remain a member state. Scotland did not vote that it should remain. Scotland is not and never has been a member state of the European Union. The whole of the United Kingdom is going to be leaving the European Union because the United Kingdom as a whole voted for it. And Alec Neil was refreshingly candid and honest about this. Yes.
Stuart Stevenson.
I wonder if the member could tell us if Greenland has ever been a state member of the European Union. And perhaps in answering, he might remember that it was able separately to deal with its membership status, notwithstanding its lack of being a member state.
Adam Tomkins.
As the member knows, Greenland is not and never has been a member state of the European Union, and I'll come to reverse Greenland's in a few moments, if I may. What Scots now want, Deputy Presiding Officer, is for their two governments to work together to secure the best possible Brexit deal for Scotland and for the United Kingdom. And what the evidence tells us about this, the evidence tells us that Scotland will be able to secure a preferential deal, such as perhaps a reverse Greenland model, as was just alluded to. Scotland will be able to secure a preferential deal only if it cooperates and is seen internationally to cooperate with the United Kingdom government. Why? Because it is the United Kingdom that is the member state, not Scotland. And if this is too much of a constitutional law lecture for Tavish Scott, then I'm not going to apologise for this, because this is a political debate about constitutional law. Yeah. Constitutional law and politics are at the moment deeply entwined, I'm afraid. Scottish ministers have talked of preserving Scotland's status in the European Union. But Scotland formally has no legal status in the European Union. In the withdrawal negotiations, if I can quote from a paper by Graham Avery for the European Policy Centre, in the withdrawal negotiations, which are intergovernmental in character, the British government
will represent the United Kingdom. Scotland will not have a separate voice. That's why EU governments say that only London is competent to conduct the negotiations, not my words, but those of Graham Avery. Now, the European and External Relations Committee made this point very forcefully in paragraph 10 of its report, published earlier this week, which we've quoted from in our amendment to this afternoon's motion. If Scotland wants a distinctive relationship with the European Union, it must first agree that approach with the United Kingdom government. So the most pressing consideration, therefore, is that the Scottish government cooperates in good faith with the United Kingdom government in pursuing the best possible Brexit deal for Scotland and the United Kingdom. And as Jackson Carlaw has said, not belligerence, but diplomacy will secure that. Not sabre-rattling about independence, but collaboration. Not renewed threats of another IndyRef, but good faith and sincere cooperation with the United Kingdom government. I know that my friend Mr. Russell is capable of it, but we will expect him to deliver it. Yes.
Tavish Scott.
That may or may not, I'm very grateful to Adam Thomas for giving me that, may or not be true. When is the UK going to sort its position out?
The next section of my speech, Mr. Scott will be pleased to know, is called What Brexit Means. So.
3.5 minutes.
How long have I got?
3.5 minutes.
Now, let me start by explaining what I think Brexit does not mean. Lawyers always define what things are by reference to what they're not. You know that. There is a fallacy, it seems to be, a false antithesis, which is gaining ground in Scottish public debate, which needs to be arrested. That is to say, there is some kind of binary divide between hard Brexit and soft. Now, I know the nationalists like to divide everybody into, you know, yes camps and no camps, and they like binary divides, but there's not a binary divide between hard Brexit and soft Brexit, notwithstanding the contributions earlier from Ross Grier and Joan McAlpine and others. The softest form of Brexit would be EEA membership. EEA membership would require, first, full participation in the single market, including full free movement of workers. So, in other words, not taking back control of our borders. It would require, secondly, substantial financial contributions to the European institutions, so not taking back control of our national finances. And it would require continued subjection to the supranational case law of the European Court of Justice, including its doctrine of supremacy over national legislation, so not taking back control of our legislation either. So the European, let me just finish the point about the EEA, and then I'll give way to Mr. MacDonald. So the EEA is a way, was designed, I think, about 20 years ago, as a way into the European Union, not as a way out of the European Union. I'll give it away to Mr. MacDonald.
Lewis MacDonald.
I may have misheard Adam Tonkman's a few minutes ago, but I'm sure he said that Liechtenstein offered an example of a member of the EEA which had qualified free movement of people. Which position is it that he's putting forward to the Parliament tonight? Is he supporting membership of the EEA because it does or because it does not have that free movement, or is he rejecting it?
Adam Tompkins.
The position of the EEA membership requires acceptance of all three of these points. It requires acceptance of the single of free movement of workers. It requires acceptance of a substantial financial contribution to the EU, and it requires acceptance of the continued supremacy of EU law over national legislation. And for a combination of all of those three reasons, I don't think that EEA. My personal view is that I do not think that EEA membership is consistent with taking back control. Equally, however, being completely outside the single market would, in my view, be contrary to the British national interest. So the critical question is this. The critical question is not, are we members of the single market or not? The critical question is, what kind of access to the single market or what kind of participation in the single market do we now want and on what terms? Last week,
the First Minister
castigated the Prime Minister for...
I'm sorry, Mr. Thompson has to close.
Last week, the First Minister castigated the Prime Minister for refusing to answer the question whether she wanted the UK to be a member of the single market or not. But this reveals not any ambivalence on the Prime Minister's part, but the First Minister's lack of understanding about what is now at stake. Because,
closing,
as I've said
now, please,
many
Mr.
times
Tompkins.
This afternoon, Presiding Officer, there is no such thing as membership of the single market. The EEA and the single market are not the same thing. The question is what kind of access to, what kind of participation in the single market do we now consider it to be in the national interest? Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Fiona Hislop. I'd appreciate a wee bit brevity if you could, Cabinet Secretary. Definitely no longer than 9.5 minutes.
Presiding Officer, the enormity of the challenge of addressing the EU referendum vote cannot and must not be underestimated. This government moves swiftly and decisively to ensure Scotland's interests would be addressed, as did the Parliament, and I too welcome the European and External Relations Committee's initial report, having given evidence to that committee barely a week after the EU vote itself. I said then that influencing the UK government's negotiations before triggering Article 50 would be key, and our new Minister Michael Russell set out his role and focus in his opening speech and will be meeting David Davis tomorrow in London. The Scottish Government also needs to ensure that EU institutions and member states understand Scotland's position and, importantly, that we understand theirs. The First Minister met and talked with the President of the European Parliament, the President of the European Commission, the leaders of the main political groups in Brussels, Scottish MEPs, the UK's permanent representative to the EU, and the German Minister of State, Michael Roth. The Minister for Europe and I have met with ambassadors and ministers from 12 EU countries over the summer. In the last 2 weeks, I have met and spoken with the Taoiseach, Enda Kenny, and the Irish Foreign Minister, Charlie Flanagan, and met with the ambassadors of Finland, Denmark, and Austria. In the next few days, I will be in Italy. In each of these meetings, the Scottish Government has set out Scotland's position, that Scotland voted to remain, that we will work to positively influence Article 50 negotiations by the UK government, and that we are looking at all options to protect Scotland's interests. The UK government has said that the Scottish government will be fully involved in preparations for negotiations, and that Article 50 will not be triggered until we have a UK approach and objective for negotiations. We will hold the Prime Minister and her government to that commitment. And the Scottish Government established the Standing Council on Europe so we can look at all options in detail, in depth, and with expertise. Now, members have raised today a broad range of important issues which must be taken into account in the negotiations with the UK Government. And this debate has been important in setting out the expectations of members of this Parliament. So let me respond and highlight some of those now with reference to the 5 key tests that the First Minister set out and which Michael Russell referenced at the opening of this debate. The democratic interest, the economic interest, social protection, solidarity and influence. And Lewis MacDonald, in what I thought was a very considered speech, talked about the importance of remaining fully in the single market. And any relationship with the European Union that falls short of that risks reducing exports to the EU, the introduction of tariffs and other non-tariff trade barriers. Now, Adam Tonkins in an intervention in his last speech talked about the kind of access to the single market that we want. But there is a serious point here. The idea that the UK is going to be able to pick and choose aspects of that is something really we have to get a grip and have a reality check on. Joan McAlpine was very correct when she said that we can't square access to the single market with prevention of freedom of movement, and a point that Guy Verhofstadt, the EU Parliament's negotiator, has also underlined. But the importance of the single market is not just about access for goods, it is about all 4 freedoms, including the free movement of people. Ross Green, on behalf of the Greens, set out the importance of the wider aspects of freedom of movement and the importance to this particular country of migration and the impact it has. Ash Denham talked about the human face of what that meant in terms of the position on the EU for EU nationals. And it's also about the people who work here in our key industries. Rachel Hamilton talked about the importance of the food and drink industry and tourism. I met with a number of EU nationals at the Deanston Distillery. 17% of our tourism industry is dependent on workers. And obviously, food and drink, that also has a big impact, about 16% in the number of the workers. And she talked about the importance of being able to get new markets as part of the position post-Brexit. But there is a very important aspect as when and how those markets would develop. And it's quite clear from even the G20 discussions last week that the issue will be after negotiations have been completed with the EU for many countries, and indeed the UK may be at the end of that list. So other areas that have been raised, Colin Smith talked about the importance of agriculture, Stuart Stevenson on fishing. I want to move on to social protection. And our membership of the EU has not only brought us economic growth, but has ensured that alongside that growth, social protection has been championed. And it really is important that we make sure we're in a position that that is protected. The idea of an unshackled race to the bottom of exploitation of workers is something that both Claire Hawkey and Neil Findlay highlighted. And we won't tolerate any attempt to downgrade those social protections. At that point. Mike Rumbles.
I have heard a lot, quite rightly, about protecting EU nationals living in Scotland as far as their residence and employment rights are concerned. But I haven't heard from the Scottish Government anything yet about Scots living abroad in the EU and how we want to protect theirs. I haven't heard it yet.
Fiona Hislop.
The First Minister was in committee this morning, and I would refer all members to look at that evidence as well for developing the Scottish Government's position. Mary Evans, in a very thoughtful and well-informed speech, talked about the importance of community-led projects and the different perspective of transnational funds, and also warned about the existing reticence, perhaps, to develop new projects. And that's something we should be very mindful of as we go forward. And we also, as a government, want to see that the arguments of solidarity are supported. The issues around climate change and, importantly, on justice. Brexit does put at risk a range of cooperations in relation to civil and criminal law, and it's imperative that our interests in Scotland are protected in any future arrangements. And indeed, before Brexit, the first test will be the UK's government's immediate view on the Europol regulations that are coming soon. And we must have influence in the decision that affects us, and that will come down to, I think, future debates of what type of relationship we can secure in those negotiations with the UK government. And the reflection on the democratic interests. The Scottish Government is taking forward the views of Scotland as presented at the EU referendum. But we will also make sure that in terms of representing the Scotland's interests is promoted at that vote. Michael Russell will set out the position of the Scottish Government in his discussions with the UK, and that first meeting is tomorrow. And I think everybody in the Chamber wishes him well in that first discussion with David Davis, and that is the spirit in which we'll be entering in those discussions. But gently and very politely to the Conservatives, having a patronising constitutional law lecture by Adam Tompkins or an obfuscating diversionary bluster from Jackson Carlow from a party whose reckless politics has led to the position we're in, that condescension is not conducive to consensus or collaboration. And if we're going to go forward in the debates that we are going to have in this chamber about EU matters in the future, let's try and do it in a spirit of respect and understanding. And I also would want to look forward to the next steps. I would refer all members to look at the official report of the First Minister's appearance at the European and External Relations Committee from today. Today, we have also seen Jean-Claude Juncker's State of the Union's address. But the clock is ticking, and there are further future events in the EU that will have bearing on developments. The Bratislava Summit was taking place on the 16th of this month, and it is the first summit without the UK. It's the EU27, and that is of significance. Negotiations about the EU budget post-2020 are likely to start in 2018, and that will clearly focus the minds of the EU27. We have French and German elections in 2027, and the European Parliament elections are due in 2019. Now, Tavish Scott made a very good speech, and he reflected on the perspective and the importance of looking at this process as one that will not be quick. But we are in uncharted territory. Brexit, as Ash Denham pointed out, has not happened yet. We are at the start of the process to start the process of Brexit. And we must work creatively and positively and constructively to shape a future which reflects and respects Scotland's interests. I think in this Parliament we have that political will to try and shape that future. There's definitely a will in wider civic Scotland, and this government will work to explore all options. And, Presiding Officer, we will continue to update Parliament in doing so. And in that spirit, I urge all members of this Parliament to support the motion. Yeah.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on the implications of the EU referendum result and UK negotiating position. And before we move on to the next item of business, members may wish to join me in welcoming to the gallery the Honourable Antonio José Amelia MP, Deputy Speaker of the Assembly of the Republic of Mozambique. Thank you. The next item of business is consideration of Business Motion 1429 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. I would ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press their request to speak button now, and I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move Motion 1429.
Formally moved.
Thank you. No member has asked to speak against the motion. I will put the question to the Chamber. The question is that Motion 1429 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The next item of business is consideration of three Parliamentary Bureau motions. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move on block Motion 1430 on the variation of standing orders, Motion 1431 on parliamentary recess dates, and Motion 1432 on suspension of standing orders.
Moved on block.
Thank you, Mr. Fitzpatrick. These questions will be put at decision time, to which we now come. Now, there are four questions to be put at decision time. I remind members that if the amendment in the name of Jackson Carlow is agreed, the amendment in the name of Lewis MacDonald falls. The first question is that amendment 1412.2 in the name of Jackson Carlow, which seeks to amend motion number 1412, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. Members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment 1412.2 in the name of Jackson Carlow is yes 29, no 93. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The next question is that amendment 1412.3 in the name of Lewis MacDonald, which seeks to amend motion number 1412, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Sorry, are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. Oh, I'm sorry. Apologies, we are not agreed. We will move to a vote. Members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 1412.3 in the name of Lewis MacDonald is yes 112, no 5. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed. The next question is that motion 1412 in the name of Michael Russell as amended is agreed. Are we all agreed?
No!
We are. Thank you. We are not agreed. Members will move to a vote. Members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion 1412 in the name of Michael Russell as amended is yes 87, no 34. There were no abstentions. The motion as amended is therefore agreed. Finally, I propose to ask a single question on Parliamentary Bureau Motions 1430, 1431 and 1432. If any member objects to a single question being put, please say so now. No member has objected. Therefore, the question is that motions 1430 to 1432 be agreed. Are we agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. That concludes decision time. We will now move to members' business, and I'll take a few minutes to change seats.